We are all here to hear from Dr. Hegde, but before we do that, it would be nice for us to remember then what a great presence we are. Allow me to call upon the General Secretary of Kannada Kuta, Mr. Prabhu Achar, to introduce to us the many credentials of our esteemed guest this morning. But let's do it. Let's see if we can do it. You would be very humble. We'd like to hear the actual version.
And it would be a pleasure to introduce you, sir. And it's a lifetime opportunity, I would believe, for me. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Like I just said, I would repeat myself, it gives me immense pleasure and reverence to introduce Padmabushan Dr. B.M. Hegde. He is an international acclaimed physician, cardiologist, medical scientist, educationalist, author of many books, and on top of all, he is the finest orator. Ladies and gentlemen, let's give a big round of applause to Professor B.M. Hegde. Honorable Dr. Hegde has received many awards, honors, fellowships from all over the world. Dr. Hegde has numerous qualifications to his profiles, including MBBS from Stanley Medical College, Madras University, MD from King George Medical College, Lucknow, and various other fellowships, including MRCP, FRCP, FACC, FRCPG, FAMS from various prestigious medical schools in UK, USA, Europe, and India. A born teacher, Professor B.M. Hegde started teaching in medical schools almost at the age of 23. Starting as a tutor, he badged to be the Vice Chancellor of Manipal University. He trained in some of the best institutions in India, the UK, and the USA under great legendary teachers. He was one of the rare Indians appointed as regular visiting professor of cardiology at Middlesex Hospital Medical School, University of London, way back in 1982. His chief, late Dr. Walter Somerville, was then the editor of British Heart Journal for almost 30 years. Professor B.M. Hegde was also the first Indian teacher to be invited to examine at the Royal College's final examination since 1988, both in the UK and Ireland. Dr. B.M. Hegde has received many prestigious awards, including one of the India's highest civilian award, Padma Bhushan, was awarded to him in 2010. Dr. B.C. Roy National Award in the category of Eminent Medical Teacher. Dr. J.C. Bose Award for Research in Life Sciences, Distinguished Physician of Award, Indian Award, Karnataka Rajyotsava Award, Vaidya Ratnakara Award from Shankaracharya, 12 gold medals, orations, and many more. Let's have a big round of applause for Dr. B.M. Hegde. Dr. Hegde has served in various struts and widely respected in for his philanthropic acts. Dr. Hegde doctorates Indian way of integrating healing system, including Ayurveda, yoga, breathing system, breathing techniques, and other healing systems and methods. I now, on behalf of IDF, IDAC, and Kuwait Kannada Kuta, request Professor B.M. Hegde to enlighten us with his keynote address on healthy lifestyle for better life. Can we have a big round of applause, and let's welcome with a warm.
But don't believe what he said. You know, at the end of all that, I was reminded of what Johanna von Goethe, one of the greatest thinkers in this world, a German, said. I quote, "I now know philosophy, physiology, jurisprudence, medicine, science, even alas theology from end to end with labor skin. But here I stand, O fool, with all my lore, no wiser than before." Which is absolutely true. Because, you know, it's wisdom that is missing in this world. T.S. Eliot so beautifully said, where is that wisdom we seem to have lost in knowledge? And where is that knowledge we seem to have lost in information? Today we only gather information. And information is full of noise. An occasional signal in the information is lost in the noise. So much so, you get so confused listening to various things. How many of you heard of this man called Crick? William Crick. C-R-E-E-C-K. Have you heard of that? Very famous German economist who has written an article for all of you to read, The End of Capitalism. He said Brexit and Trump's election is a sign of an imminent breaking up of capitalism in the West. Because capitalism has oversold itself. It's oversold itself so much so. Today, everything runs on money. Did you understand that? Everything runs on money. Man is of no consequence. Only money is consequence. I don't know how many of you know, when the first industry started in 1802 in England, that's called the Industrial Revolution or Renaissance or what you want to call it, of the last century, 19th century. There was this romantic British poet called William Wordsworth. He wrote a poem which is called, "The World is Too Much With Us." How many of you read that? "The World is Too Much With Us." I'll give you four lines. You go and read the rest. Get into Google and say, "William Wordsworth, The World is Too Much With Us." But this is a very important poem. It says, "The world is too much with us, late and soon. Getting and spending, we lay waste our powers." Mark that line. Getting and spending, we lay waste our powers. Little do we see in nature that is ours. I'll give you an example. If your cat in the house has a tummy ache, do you know where it goes? It goes out in the garden, knows which leaf or grass to eat, and gets better. You and I get a tummy ache, we go to an ass called BM Hegde and get a poison and get into trouble after that, which is called ADR, adverse drug reactions. The leading cause of death in the world is ADR. Do you want to know that? You all think, oh, what is modern medicine? Western medicine is so good. Don't have to worry. One person came and told me, "Look, I am rich. I want to drink good scotch whiskey every day. And I want to smoke. But at the same time, I don't want to get any disease. Can you do something?" I said, "I'm sorry, you have come to the wrong person. I'm not God." "Then what is this? What is this modern medicine for? I just want to do what I want to do, and I want a medicine to cure it." This is the stage we have reached. Little do we see in nature that's ours. Because, he says, Wordsworth says, "We have sold our soul. We have sold our soul." I added two lines for that. "To the devil." Semicolon. "The sordid boon." The biggest curse for mankind is we have sold our soul. Do you even bat an eyelid to cheat somebody? Tell me that. Do you? No. And you think, "I can cheat the world and make money. I'll be happy." No, you're not happy. You may have the best possible things. You may have a 100-bedded, probably 120-floor house in Bombay. You may gift a 432 crores plane for your wife's birthday. And you may have all the cars in the world. But if you ask yourself a question at the end of the day, what is a car meant for? Take you from point A to B, right? What does it matter whether it's 800 Maruti or a crore worth of 7 series BMW where the door opens and closes on itself? What does it matter? You're going to the same place. See, this is the problem. But unfortunately, what happens is all of us are governed by the same emotions and passions. So beautifully said, Shakespeare, whether you are in the palace or in the pad, whether in the castle or in the cottage, you are governed by the same emotions and passions. Greed, jealousy. Actually, greed is a very small word. Wall Street greed is a better word. That's the corporate greed. Wall Street greed. Because there's no end to it. Just there is no end to it. $13 billion is the profit of one drug company. One drug company in 1 year. $13 billion is the profit of one drug company in America by selling statins. Knowing full well that statins are poisons, and they're going to kill a lot of people. 10% to 40% of people who take statin within 1 year become diabetics. Now we say we don't want diabetes. No. We are manufacturing diabetes. I have estimated 15 million people in India take statins. 15 million. That means we are manufacturing 2 million diabetics every year. And then we say India will be the capital of diabetes in the world. Naturally. This is all because of Wall Street greed. Did you understand that? What it means? Yeah. Tyrosine kinase receptor blocker. There are a lot of doctors here. You know, tyrosine kinase receptor blocker is a good anti-cancer agent. One drug manufactured in America or by an American company, maybe manufactured in China or Vietnam or Honolulu or Timbuktu, I don't know. But packaged and marketed by a company in America costs 2.5 lakhs of rupees for one injection. And what hurts me is our cancer specialists tell the patient, with this drug, you will become completely all right. I'll give you an example. One of my students, who was a professor of cardiovascular surgery in St. John's Medical College in Bangalore, 44-year-old young man with a child and a young wife, comes down with acute myeloblastic leukemia. So his wife calls me and says, "Uncle, he has got this, and in Kidwai they say, you know, they'll treat conventionally." I said, "Fine, that's the maximum that can happen, because acute myeloblastic leukemia, if he survives, it's great, something, you know, providential. Otherwise, normally they don't survive." How could I tell her that? Then she said, "Do you know why she called me?" She said, "Sir, in Vellore they say there's a special treatment, there's a special unit. They'll make him all right." I said, "Do you believe that in 2016? She said, "No, there's so many people have assured me." I said, "Don't believe these things. These are all, you know, this advertisement. Kidwai is all right. You know, whatever. What he requires is TLC, tender loving care. You know, tender loving care. TLC is the best medicine for many diseases. You probably don't know that. Because ultimately the healing is done by your own body. Remember that. Healing is done by your own immune system and not by the surgery or by any medicine that you take, be it homeopathy, umapathy, ayurveda, anything. Ultimately, it is sympathy that matters. I always tell my students, you practice whatever you want to practice, but do practice empathy and sympathy. You will be a good doctor. I'll give you a study. WHO did a study in Thailand. Thailand has 5 systems of medicine concurrently running. Pure Western medicine, as you know, we Indians think Western medicine is the panacea for all things, right? Most of us think like that. Pure Chinese medicine, integrated Western Chinese medicine, Samoa medicine, where the father tells the son what to do when he dies, and the son tells his son when he dies, and it goes on. Then Quakery, downright Quakery, RMPs, as they call in India, registered medical practitioners. Now, WHO did a study. What was the impact of these 5 systems of medicine on society in Thailand? Would you know what came out? They're equally effective. Equally effective. The quack was as effective as the best Western doctor. Because if the Western doctor has sympathy, immune system takes over. The quack has always sympathy. That's his trump card, without which he won't practice. And he is always successful. A quack is always successful. I was a student in the 50s in Madras, and opposite our big hospital, which is Asia's biggest hospital those days, there was a doctor called UL Janardhan Rao or someone, a Brahmin old man. When I was 17 years old, he was 70 years old. And he was practicing medicine then with an LIM, which he got 70 years earlier. LIM means they don't eat nothing there. But if we had 2,000 outpatients, he had about 1,500 outpatients. And his queue used to be from Parktown via Chinatown to the almost to beach. That was the queue in the morning. Every day. The old man will have a stethoscope. Once I saw that, it's about a meter long, because he doesn't touch these patients. You know, poor patients, they smell and all, they don't take bath, he thinks. So he has an assistant who takes a chest piece and puts it on the patient's chest like that. And this fellow will keep it in the earpiece here. There are three rooms. Patients come in one room, he sits in the middle room, and the third room is on the other side. Every patient comes with a bottle. Those days there were no tablets. You know, when I was a student, we had only few mixtures. So they bring a bottle, put the bottle there, a big receptacle will be kept. And the thing is taken through the compounder's room to the other side. Compounder fills some medicine in some bottle, which is whose bottle is what, nobody knows. And that is taken to the third room, and when the patients pass out, they pick up their bottles and go. Very interesting thing happens. Patient comes in, he is ushered in, he says, Enna, Enna in Tamil means what? And by the time he opens his mouth, that fellow is, you know, jargandi, you know, like in Tirupati temple, he is already jargandi next. And in between, the chest piece touches the patient once. That's all what happens. And obviously, patients get better, otherwise they won't come back. Because he doesn't advertise. Those days there are no television to advertise, or there are no paper advertising saying, come here, we will do your, you know, you'll give you a new foot, or we'll give you a new heart, nothing like that. Word of mouth. Patients from all over Chennai and the surrounding suburbs used to come to UL Narayan Rao. That impressed me a lot. As a young child, I was looking at UL Narayan Rao and appreciating, my God, he's God. Today, you know, he is very scientific. Very, very scientific. My former chief in Harvard, who is 92 years old, still directs research. Saparwala Sab. His name is Bernard Laun, who is a Nobel laureate. Who is that shocking machine that they all use in the hospital? He invented that. He directed research about 10 years ago. What did he do? 600 patients over a 5-year period were sent up for bypass surgery to the Harvard Medical School from the Massachusetts cardiologists. And they were doing laser tip bypass surgery. It's called total myocardial infarction. Nothing, no cutting the chest and nothing of the sort. Patient doesn't even know. You just put a catheter in and make holes in the heart and convert a man into a snake. Snakes don't have a coronary system. They suck blood from the cavity through the holes. So we make a man a snake and then he's okay. He said, none of these people scientifically require bypass surgery. So he devised a new study. Patient comes, number one, goes to theater A. Patient comes number two, goes to theater B. C, A, third patient, fourth patient B, alternate patients at random. Close your eyes and randomize to do that. And the protocol in theater A was in anesthetize, operate, send. In B was anesthetize, keep him sleeping. When he wakes up, tell him he had a wonderful operation, send. Do nothing. Okay? 298 here and 299 here. Now at the end of 5 years, all these 299 who went to theater B are perfect. Now thallium scan shows their revascularization is 100% perfect. In A, half of them, the chest pain did not go, so they had to have a cut open, regular surgery. The other half of the half are with their maker in heaven. The remaining half of the half, they're having ADR, adverse drug reactions, because of ticlopidine, aspirin, and what have you, all the blood thinners. They've had cerebral hemorrhage, this, that, problems. But those who went to theater B are all happy. Now, what happened to them? They were told at the end, when they woke up from anesthesia, your operation has been very successful. That's it. That's called the placebo effect. The body's immune system corrects it and opens up collaterals, just as body does in all of us. Sitting here, all of us, including the children, we all have, mark my words, we all have coronary artery blocks. If you didn't have, you wouldn't be here. About 5% of human beings don't get coronary blocks and they die before the age of 25 of a sudden heart attack. This is called preconditioning, nature preconditions. And the same nature does what it does. Now somebody wanted to know, what happens when you take a chemical medicine? Chemical medicine is a new idea, Western idea. Wall Street greed, eh? You don't know that. I'll tell you what. They said, what will happen? So a professor of medicine, to be very precise, professor of genetics in Washington, Douglas C. Wallace, D. C. Wallace, did a wonderful study. He invented a chip called the MIT chip, mitochondrial chip, his own invention. So he tags it on to the drug and gives the drug to the patient and traces it where it goes. The chemical drug goes inside the system to the stomach, and the human immune system, human wisdom says, what is this? This chemical I have not seen. My forefathers have not seen. It's never been in our race. So it must be some poison which has come in. Throw it to the liver. That's what happens to any poison. You take a poison, it's first sent to the liver. So every chemical drug that you swallow goes to the liver. Mark my words. Every drug goes to the liver. When it goes to the liver tries to best it possible destroy it. If something remains, it comes out of the liver. That's called the first pass effect. Some of the medical doctors here sitting must have heard pharmacology class. First pass effect. First pass effect means what remains of the comes out of the liver. It's a very small amount. That might do harm. But the liver is definitely damaged. That's why today we have a new disease called non-alcoholic cirrhosis of the liver. It's an epidemic actually. When I was a student, we only knew one thing. Cirrhosis means alcoholic cirrhosis. Now new disease is almost cirrhosis, alcoholic cirrhosis has disappeared because people are now afraid drinking too much of alcohol. There are a few. But every one of us possibly is a candidate for non-alcoholic cirrhosis. Is it not, if it's not greed, what else is? Tell me. So Douglas so beautifully showed that none of these drugs are accepted by the human system. Whereas he tried Chinese and Tibetan herbs. He didn't try Ayurveda because Ayurveda is very unpopular in the West. Or at least it's becoming popular now. But in America, Ayurveda has not been very popular. But he took Chinese herbs and Tibetan herbs. The minute the herb goes into the stomach says, aha, this is new. This is, I know it. It's a part of the food that my ancestors were taking. And it's not thrown into the liver. And directly goes, and if it can do some good, it does. This is what happens with all herbal medicines. Unfortunately, the present Ayurveda in India, any Ayurvedic physicians here? They are also now trying reductionist chemicals. The other day means about 1 year ago, or 2 years ago, I was lecturing at the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research in Bombay. They get crores of money for research. And they were telling me, sir, we tried this, you know, Ayurveda is all hocus pocus, sir. We tried this Brahmi, you know Brahmi, Ekpatta, which is supposed to be good for memory. My grandmother used to give us chutney of Brahmi before we go to the exam. I still remember that. Brahmi, you know that. What do you call that in Hindi? Kya bolta hai isko? Kya? Brahmi chi? Uh-huh. Ek patta. Malayalam enta parayunu? Ek patta le. Enta parayunu? Brahmi. Nama kannadadalli timar, nava tulivinalli timare anta helthave, timare. Timare chutney. Timare gotta? Balaruchi, balaruchi. Very nice. Anyway, they were saying, it's useless, sir. We tried so much. Then I told them, what did you try? And chemical extract of Brahmi. I said, chemical extract of Brahmi is not Brahmi. I said, why don't you try Brahmi chutney itself? And 2 or 3 boys in the audience, you know, some of these young boys are very, you know, they are imaginative. They said, yes. But they came and told me, sir, we won't get any grant for this. I said, why don't you? You just write to the DRDO. And you will get, or DST. Why not you get it? So I talked to the secretary of DST. I said, why don't you fund this kind of refutative research? You know, all your rubbish research, crores of rupees of taxpayers' money is wasted on repetitive research. Me too research. Somebody has done in America something. I'm going to do it here and see what happens. This is called repetitive research. Remember, knowledge does not advance by repeating known things. Knowledge advances by refuting false dogmas. I'll give you an example. 127 AD, Galen said, blood circulates from the liver. Okay? For 1,500 years, every ass of a professor, researcher, PhD, said, liver pumps blood. It was in the year 1628, a London doctor, practicing doctor, who didn't have much practice, was going for a walk in the evening, saw a fire hydrant and got some stimulated idea and went back to his laboratory and did a lot of dissection of animals and found out heart pumps blood, and he said, cogito, demoto cordis. In Latin, demoto cordis is heart pumps blood. That was in 1628. That means 1500 years every ass thought liver pumps blood. They taught the same thing in the medical school. Can you believe that? So repeating known things does not take knowledge forwards. Refuting false dogmas takes knowledge forwards, said Karl Popper, a great thinker who was a professor of science philosophy in the London School of Economics in the 50s and 60s. He's a colossus. Popper said, think of refuting false dogmas, of which there are many in every field, every single field. That's what Crick was saying. This economics, which we think is economics, macroeconomics, is going to end sooner than later. The signs are already there in the horizon. Trump coming up. The whole media saying Hillary will come up. And suddenly Trump comes up. See? Brexit. Cameron was so happy, so confident that, no, what is happening? I'll come. Something has come up. The white supremacy is coming up, which means we'll go back to the time of the Nazis again. See, think of it. White supremacy in America. Here is a very funny system. The American system is such that only the rich people will win at the end of the day. Hillary gets thousands of votes more than Trump in the popular vote. But in the collegiate system, he gets more. How can you believe that? Very funny, isn't it? Very funny. Now, these are all signs. So I say, Western science has had an overdose of itself. And sooner than later, this science will be exposed. Exposed. Do you understand that? If any one of you is keen on reading, younger generation, I'll give you a book, nice book, written by two physics professors in New York, called The Golem. The book's name is The Golem, G-O-L-E-M. Golem in the Malayalam? Any, you know, a lot of Malayalis here. What is Golem? Golem. Golem in the? Yes? Huh? Golem alla mole. Golem. Hindi? G-O-L-E-M is a Hebrew word. It's not an English word. Hebrew and Malayalam are same meaning. In Hebrew, G-O-L-E-M, golem, means scarecrow. Malayalathil adanne? Adha, pinne njan endu paranju. So, this is a beautiful book which says The Golem. That means science, as we are taught in school and college, is something that has been created by the Wall Street greed to keep us under their control. See, today, for example, you say, oh, Western medicine is scientific. Oh, it's scientific? Yeah, I'll take it. What is science? Tell me, what is science? Endubale? The vice president of the dental association. Keep you under control. You think, oh, it's scientific, then it must be good. They say, evidence-based science. Western medicine is evidence-based science. Where is the evidence? That you don't ask. You say evidence-based science. Oh, this Ayurveda? No, it's no good. No, not science. Who said it's not science? Actually, Ayurveda is a bigger science than the Western science. And the Western medical science is totally wrong, totally flawed. And this became a science. If you want to know the history, you'll be shocked. How did medicine become a science? The Western medicine started as mumbo-jumbo, sorcery and witchcraft on the Nile Valley 5,000 years ago. From there it moved. From Nile Valley it moved, it came to Egypt. And in Egypt, then other parts of Egypt at a lot of time. Then it came to Arabia, actually. And in Arabia, there was a great man called Ibn Sina, whom the Westerners call as Avicenna. He's not Avicenna, he's Ibn Sina, I-B-N-S-I-E-N. Ibn Sina did a lot of modifications for the Western medicine. And from here it went to Greece. And by the time it reached Greece, Alexander the Great had invaded India and come back. He died in Persia. But Alexander's followers came back to Alexandria, a city which he had built for intellectual activity. And the big building he had built called Academia. So we say, I'm in academics. You ask the people, what is academics? They wouldn't know. This academics means reading books and going to the library is called academy. No. Academia is the building where academics started. where people come and have two kinds of things. A, symposium. They come and talk like this, agree to disagree, eat and dine and wine and go. Or seminar comes from semen. So seminar is a discussion where new thoughts come out. Now, so new things born. Today we interchangeably use it in any way you like. But the original thing is symposium is totally different from seminar. Seminar is different from symposium. That is why academics, anybody who goes there is supposed to be an academic. Not because you go to the library and have a PhD. You know what PhD is? Huh? PhD? Doctor of philosophy. Huh? Good. Yes. No. If you steal from one person, it's called plagiarism. When you steal from 100 people, it's called PhD. Did you get that? Yeah. That's the difference between the two. Plagiarism also, you know, high level people do plagiarism. Doesn't matter. But if you... Today, in India, the situation is a little different. I don't know how many of you know. The UGC said, even to become an assistant professor, you must have a PhD. So we have PhDs galore now. Very interesting. Every other person is a PhD. And it's very easy to get PhD because, you know, even in America, you can get PhD. If there are the institutions where you give $5,000, you'll get a PhD thesis written and you get a PhD. In India, it is still cheaper. You don't have to go that far. You get very cheap. There are people who write PhD thesis. You have to give them the subject. There are examiners who give you a pass. There are universities which connive with that. Can you believe that? All this happens because the greed at the end. It's again economics greed. If you get a PhD, you get a promotion. If you get a PhD, you get higher pay. If you get a PhD, you're better. So it's better than the others. It's one-upmanship. So this is how the world runs. Remember that? Now come back to Douglas Black's work. What did Douglas Wallace show? Any drug that you give, which is a reductionist chemical, destroys the body, destroys the liver, and damages the liver. And if any good effect comes, it is from what little comes out of the liver. And the leading cause of death today in the West is adverse drug reactions. And the doctor's establishment is the leading cause of death. Did you know that? The medical establishment is the leading cause of death. In 5 countries in the last 25 years, doctors went on strike where there are no private doctors. Saskatchewan in Canada 25 years ago, Los Angeles County 15 years ago, Bogota in Colombia 10 years ago, and recently in Israel, doctors went on strike. An audit now shows each time the doctors went on strike, death rate simply disappeared, almost came down. Morbidity came down. Can you believe that? Nurses were running the hospital. Recently in Dublin, there is a very interesting thing. The junior doctors went on strike. The senior consultants were still holding fort. But the senior consultant has forgotten how to give intravenous drips and, you know, the simple things, the procedures, how to incise an abscess, etc., etc. So much so, interventions came down and mortality came down and morbidity came down. British Medical Journal wrote a beautiful editorial. Doctors going on strike will improve society's health for sure. Did you get that? Now comes the very famous 14-country study of the industrialist countries from Japan to USA. And this study is published. You want the reference? Write down. Is US medicine the best in the world? That's the heading. Nama Doctors Forum, our ophthalmologist is writing. Is US medicine the best in the world? Write down. That's the heading. The author's name is Barbara Starfield, who teaches community medicine in Johns Hopkins Hospital. She's a very nice girl. And they wanted to kill her. Eventually, she died of an accident. I don't know whether she is killed or not. And this article came in the JAMA, J-A-M-A. Moladhya. 2000, year is 2000. Semicolon, volume is 284. Colon, page is 483. Vaikanam, this is a free article. You go to Google and say, Barbara Starfield, is US medicine the best in the world? JAMA, 2000, semicolon, 284, colon, 483. and you will see for your shock that the leading cause of death is the medical establishment. Why? Over-intervention, over-diagnosis, mismanagement, over-management, under-management. A study showed that people who don't have high blood pressure, genuine disease, just, you know, their pressure is slightly raised when they see a doctor, which is called white coat hypertension. These people are unnecessarily drugged and the drugs produce problems. People of genuine high blood pressure with a lot of problems, they are not adequately treated and they die. So they have either over-treatment or under-treatment. Seeing this, Mary Tinetti, who is the professor of medicine in Yale, wrote a nice study in the Archives of Internal Medicine. Archives of Internal Medicine. That heading is, write down the heading. Mary Tinetti. Mary, MaryTinetti. Mary Tinetti. The End of the Disease Era. That's the heading of the article. What's the heading of the article? The End of the Disease Era. That means this diagnosis is the curse. Diagnosis is a disease in itself. You make a diagnosis and attack it. You don't, you know what happens to the human being? You're not worried. You're only worried attacking the diagnosis. Archives of Internal Medicine. Arch Int Med. 2004. Volume 116, page 179. Now read this, and Mary tells you that all that we do today is either over-treatment, under-treatment, mistreatment or maltreatment, but not real treatment. Anyway, why did I say all this preface? Just to tell you that you are here because of you and not because of doctors. You are here if you are alive. In spite of doctors, you are terribly lucky. Did you get that message? Just telling you the truth, that is, you are cured by your own immune system. This is the most important thing. And our job should be to boost our immune system. That's the essence of Ayurveda. Swastasya swastha rakshitam. Preserve the health of the well. How do you do that? Boost the immune system. Panchakarma, for example. Ayurveda's thrust is Panchakarma. There are five methods of boosting your immune system. But I tell you, better than that, there is only one system. Love everybody. Love everybody. Hate nobody. Don't do anything in overdose. Do what you love and love what you do. Have a wife or husband of your choice if you can. But if you can't, love the husband or the wife that you get. All wives are happy. All wives are happy. But the truth. There's a beautiful book called Stress and Distress, written by one of the pundits of stress research called O'Malley. No. His name is something else. Anyway, I'll come back to that. And he writes there beautifully. If you love what you do, and if you love your surroundings, all the associates, you love your boss, you love your assistant, you love your wife, you love your husband, you have no problem at all in life. Our problem is we don't love people. We hate people, H-A-T-E, and that's the most dangerous thing to happen. When you hate somebody, your problems start. That is why in Ayurveda, there are five levels of the mind. The mind is one word in English language, but in Sanskrit there are five levels. Manas is the mind of a child. You know, so beautiful. Have you seen a child, newborn child, recently? No. If you're not, go to the maternity ward and see the newborn child. There are two kinds of children. One child comes out and very curious. Another child. The first one is coming here for the first time, so it's curious to know what's happening. The second one has come here several times. It couldn't care less what is happening. It has seen it all. But they smile at everyone the minute they start spotting people. Maybe a few months. Smile at anybody. B.M. Hegde comes, it smiles. Jiten comes, it smiles. And whoever comes, it smiles. But do you do that? No, you don't do that. You smile at certain people and you don't want to see someone else's face. That is where the problem starts. I've been following this, what's called HRV. We were doing studies for about 40 years now. Heart rate variability. A child's heart is very interesting. When the child breathes, the heart runs fast. When the child breathes out, it runs slow. Which we foolish Western physiologists call it as sinus arrhythmia. That is a real arrhythmia. Arrhythmia is health and arrhythmia is death. Now, as you grow old and start hating people, then your heart becomes regular and regular and regular and regular. HRV decreases. And the day it totally stops and you're absolutely regular, you're dead. Don't laugh, I'm seriously telling you. I wish I had my slides to show you how this happens, you know. These people who become absolutely regular are dead within about a couple of hours. But you can bring them from that state to the child state by doing pranayama. So beautifully. And pranayama is so good that you can bring them back to what's called tranquility. And that's where you can treat or, you know, use preventive measures. Yoga has that capacity to do that. That's why, thanks to our Prime Minister, yoga has now been recognized all over the world. A movement which he moved in the UNO, record 172 countries okayed it to have 21st of June as the International Yoga Day. 172 countries. And today you must see, you know, I was in Lisbon last year. They invited me. There's a fascinating place in Lisbon. And there's a man who is Portuguese, but calls himself Swami Surya Prakash Ananda or somebody, and has the ochre robe. And he has got a big band of people doing yoga. And I was there for the 21st, and then we went up to the dais, and one old lady comes. Oh, how old is she? 98. And she says, I've been doing yoga for the last 40 years. And she comes, it's a very high dais, and some of us had to be helped. She just jumps up and comes. You know, I always tell, you can say a man is healthy or not by knowing what he takes two at a time. Did you get that? Stairs and pills. If he takes two stairs at a time, he will live another 50 years. If he takes two pills at a time, I don't know how long he will live. This girl was taking two steps, jumping, you know, two stairs. And then she comes and we stand there and we all say, Om. This girl says, Om. By the time we all finished, this girl was still saying, Om. 98. Can you believe that? Such a long vital capacity. So much a vital capacity. Maximum breathing capacity. And her joints were so good because she was using them. That's why now for the Canadian Gerontology Association, I've told them, you teach your people two things. A, Indian dance forms, Bharatanatyam. If you're a Bharatanatyam exponent, your joints will be supple even when you're 100. And if you're one of those chanting the Om, your maximum breathing capacity will remain the same for any number of years you live. The two things that happen as age advances, A, joint mobility comes down, B, the vital capacity comes down. And you must see these people. And that's how the sinus arrhythmia of a child comes back to the adult also when once you become a child. When do you become a child? When you have no hang-ups. Child has no hang-up. I shouldn't talk to these people. No, I should, you know, this is a meeting, I should like this and I should... Why all those restrictions? You want to yawn? Yawn to your heart's content. Child yawns, no? You must see the sophisticated westernized lady. Why that? You want to, you know, burp? Burp. It's normal. You want to fart? Fart loudly. What is there? Haven't seen Auden's poem on farting? He says, you must know how to fart. Very nice. Auden. Very big English poem. He says, his poem is there. No man can smell his fart. You can smell everyone else's fart, not yours. The child doesn't restrict it. Supposing it wants to fart, just a child doesn't say, I'll hold it on. Each time you hold it on, your blood pressure goes up. You're holding it on, breathing against closed glottis, which is Valsalva maneuver. You're almost killing yourself. Remember that. Fart, man. What is there? No, I'm just not joking. Seriously telling you. Become a child. Become a child in every aspect of it. That means your heart rate variability will come back to child sinus arrhythmia. And when once that happens, that's why that is a manas. Now the child is sent to school. Right? There, child is given some information. Time ayam ane. Ine jaan is restrict time illa ninge ne paranjade. Angane, sheri. Time limit restricts, you know. Yesterday I was worried because, you know, the time is there, so much of programs to go on, and the children were waiting for dancing, etc. So I didn't want to. Engane avadu naan oru ella restrict aaki. And the blood pressure went up massive. Innella free for all, I vittittu. So what happens? You just send the child to school. School is said, this is BM Hegde, this is so-and-so, that is so-and-so, this is so-and-so, etc., etc. And that level of the mind is called buddhi. You know what buddhi is? What you are told. You are told. You are told you should not fart in public. That's buddhi. But child doesn't have buddhi, it's a manas. It farts. So buddhi. That's why I say every newborn child is a genius, wrote Alexis Carroll, only to be converted an idiot in school. So you become an idiot. So in the minute you become an idiot, then you become buddhi. Then after buddhi is the next level, where buddhi creates chitta. Chitta is buddhi plus ego. I am BM Hegde. I am ABCD, EFG or some whatever it is. That is called chitta. And that's the level you get lot of problems in the mind. Chitta, vritti, undulations. Nirodha, yogaha, Patanjali wrote. At the chitta level, you have so much vegetation in the mind. If you can control it, put a nirod there, not the government one, it leaks. But the real one. You become a sannyasi, you become so tranquil. So that's exactly what is called yoga. Chitta, vritti, nirodha, yoga. Yoga is not kusti. All that kusti you do, asanas, they are not yoga. Real yoga is chitta, vritti, nirodha, yoga. And yoga is not joining the Atman with Paramatman, etc., etc. Actually, Patanjali was an atheist. He never believed in God. But chitta is chitta, vritti, nirodha, yoga. So no religion can have any objection for yoga because it's not anything to do with religion. It's just the mind, that's all. And that's very interesting to know that. And last is, what is asana for? Asana is also important. Because each time you stretch your muscles, the tendons release opioids. You relax. That's why called sthiram sukham asanam. For constant ease, you must do asana. So, you do asana first and then sit and do pranayama. You become chitta vritti nirodha yoga. So, you become a child at the end of the day and you love the whole world. And you love your enemy. That's what Jesus said. Love the enemy. You even love your enemy because you forget why you in the first place you become. And forgiveness comes. And forgiveness is the biggest thing. Ayurveda says, Kshamavan. Forgive. Aptopasevi bhaveta arogyam. Now, I was so happy this morning here because they said Kannada, the Indian associations have come together. Coming together is progress. Staying together is probably what you need. And we must stay together because you are now in a far-off country. Not, of course, physically not very far off from India. But you are in a foreign country. This is your karma bhumi. Love the Kuwaitians. You have to love the Kuwaitians because it is they who have given you a place to work here and thrive. So you love them. Your health improves. Then you love yourselves. You know, now the latest Western studies have shown that the old Indian large family systems are very healthy. The sense of belonging. You know, I still remember the days when I was a child in my father's house. We were 66 children in the house. 66 children. And it's fun. Supposing morning there is idli, let us say, for breakfast. Most of the time it is ganji. But if it is idli, one idli is cut into four pieces. So you are given three pieces. That means three idlis you are given. That is three-fourths of the idli you have at the end of the day. And chutney is like that. You just touch it and check, and it goes that far. But it was fun. We used to pick one from the other plate and say run and eat and things like that. At night we had to drink milk. I still remember that. It's called Perneer. Perneer means water in milk. At the end of the day, it was only water. There's no milk in it. So it gets diluted, and you get small quantities. So that is how life was, but with a very real fun. Today, father, mother, husband, and child. Father goes out for work, tension, whether he will come back or not. Mother goes out, tension. Child goes out, you don't know, will somebody kidnap the child. So all three of you, the blood pressure keeps going up. So the tension, so they say, the sense of belonging. You know, uncles, aunties, grannies, and so many people to look after. Today you have to have a nanny, and the nanny is not interested in the child, but the granny is interested in the grandchild. So nanny will look after the child much better than the nanny. And that's the enjoyment of him. So sense of belonging. So do you know what the West does now? They always do something. They call church groups. Not that they go to church. Nobody goes to church in the West now. They call church groups a group where they behave like a family. So my suggestion is, KKK is a bad name. Huh? Ku Klux Klan. KKK, IAD... IADK, IDAK, IDF. Treat yourselves as one family, one family. Don't have that. Come together, enjoy together. At least once in 3 months, have a combined meeting where you discuss topics of common interest. Or so you call some ass like B.M. Hegde and ask him to talk some nonsense. All that is good because, you know, you just want to while away your time, forget your past, forget your worries. You know, worries and things like that keep killing you. So you forget it, you treat yourself. So my suggestion would be, you be a good one organization and love your karma bhumi and do something for your janma bhumi also. You know, do something. At least remove the myths about India that the West and the other countries have. It's all not true. You would be surprised. India had the hoariest science in the past. Very great. Now talking about it is no good. But we shouldn't talk. Let's see what the Western thinkers say. Voltaire said, I quote, Voltaire is a great French thinker. He said, when we were hunter-gatherers roaming the forest, these Indians had universities of excellence in 5 places. Where wise people from all over the world flock to get more wisdom. What a beautiful saying. Iliabas, Bandoban, Takshila, Banaras, and Nalanda. What a beautiful thing. You go to Gaya and see the Nalanda. Still the structure is there. And the structure is so beautiful. They want to revive that. And you must see the gown, the Nalanda University convocation gown, which is so good, compared to the Ku Klux Klan ground that we use from the ecumenical 12th century European universities that we have. You know, it looks like a burqa, actually. All this we have forgotten. Now, in quantum physics, a man gets the Nobel Prize and an alternate Nobel Prize for finding out that energy and matter are identical. Matter is energy and energy is matter. He calls it as E is equal to M. And he calls it as A duality. That means no duality. But the man writes an article for you. Read this. Matter is not made out of matter. Article appear in the? Matter is not made out of matter. His name is Hans, H-A-N-S, Peter, P-E-T-E-R, Dürer, D-U-R-R. Hans Peter Dürer. There he says, I call it as A-duality because there is no duality between matter and energy. But who am I compared to the Indian sages who thousands of years ago called it as Advaita? Who says that? Hans Peter Dürer, you and I don't know. And he quotes the Upanishads to prove that matter is energy, energy is matter, and the two are the same. Bahirantascha bhutanam, it is inside and outside of everything. Charam acharamevacha, it moves all the time but looks very solid. You all look solid, there's nothing solid about you. You are just a bundle of jumping leptoquarks, jumping electrons. Sukshmavateta vijnayam, it's so subtle that no vijnana, no science can see it. Absolutely true. You can't see an electron even today. Nobody has seen an electron, but people have got Nobel Prize for describing an electron without seeing it. And if you say there is God, they say, where is, have you seen God? I haven't seen God. But have you seen electron? No. Why did you get an Nobel Prize for saying electron is particle? Or electron is wave? Or electron is wavicle? Or electron is nothing? Each one of them got the Nobel Prize. J.J. Thomson in 1906 got the Nobel Prize for saying that electrons are particles. He was the director of the Cavendish Institute in Cambridge. 30 years later, his own son, J.G. Thomson, gets the Nobel Prize for saying that they are waves. Father said they are particles, son said it's waves. And Erwin Schrodinger gets it for, he said they are waves and particles at different times, wavicles. See? And all this is because we believed blindly Western science is correct and ours is wrong. This is the problem. We have a real problem, a mindset. We don't understand these things. And if you read that book, The Golem, written by two physics professors, Colin Harris and Trevor Pinch, P-I-N-C-H. Trevor Pinch. This is a very small book. You get an Indian edition on Amazon.com for 75 rupees, or a Western edition for about $5. And read the book. It will tell you what is a huge thing fraud called science. And these are not villagers like B.M. Hegde. They are professors of physics in New York. They have written that. And you must see, none of these scientific methods have any proof. E is equal to mc squared. Theory of relativity. 16 experiments showed that is wrong. But it's being taught even today in schools and colleges. Right? But 1925, there was a student in Zurich Polytechnic who was being taught by Einstein himself. And the student got up and said, and this old man was explaining, E is equal to mc. He got up and said, sir, you're talking through your hat. It's all bullshit, he told. What will happen to a student who tells a Nobel laureate professor that he's talking bullshit? What will happen to the student? He becomes an outstanding student, standing outside. For how many years? 30 years. And then gets the Nobel Prize. And the only Nobel Prize which is worth its gold is a Nobel Prize this student gets. And his name is Werner Heisenberg, who said, uncertainty principle. There's no certainty about anything. PQ is not equivalent to QP. 2 into 3 may be 6, but 3 into 2 need not be 6. We don't teach this in school. 2 into 2 is 4 always, right? Thermodynamics. Fluid can't grow up, can it? No. You keep liquid helium in a bowl, hang it up. After 2 days, the helium goes up and comes down. Where is thermodynamics? See, we don't believe this, do we? No. They said ether was there. Ether, that's where telephone used to go through ether. Now we know there is no ether. And you are still taught in school that inside an atom is a central nucleus and then electrons go around in circles, they jump from one thing to the other, right? There's nothing inside any atom. There's nothing inside an atom. 1920, Annie Besant, Charles Leadbeater, her boyfriend, and Babington, their colleague, come from Cambridge to get more wisdom in India and go to Himalayas and meditate and become yogis. And she writes a book. Annie Besant has written a book. Next time you are in Chennai, buy this book. And the book is called Occult Chemistry. Small book. Occult Chemistry. Annie Besant. Annie Besant, you know, who started the Congress Party with all the problems for us now. Anyway, now coming back to Annie Besant herself. She wrote this beautiful book where she says, when I become a yogic siddhi and when I get into that elevated state of consciousness, I can visualize the inside of atoms. 9 atoms from helium to hydrogen. And I know there is nothing inside an atom. When did she write? 1920. Now quantum physics says there is nothing inside an atom. Can you believe that? And this is what the books write and you read and you believe. And that's exactly what is called the Western medicine. My friend was telling yesterday, we have a wonderful drug now. What is that? Receptor blockers. And this, the minute you find a receptor blocker, you get a Nobel Prize. You find something very great, no Nobel Prize. Receptor blockers research is funded by the drug company. So they plant a man called Venkat Raman in Cambridge University. He finds a receptor blocker, he gets the Nobel Prize. But at the same time, the first receptor blocker researcher, Candace Pert, who was working in NIH under Saul Snyder, found out that the opioid receptors are outside the brain also. For the first time, she found out. But the boss stole the data and wrote a paper and tried to get a Nobel Prize. So this girl found out in time, went to the Nobel Committee, showing her ledger and said, it's my work, he has quoted. So the boss and the assistant both didn't get the Nobel Prize. The result was, this girl loses her job in NIH. Her name is Candace Pert. What's her name? Candace Pert. NIH is the highest court or the highest palace for research in America. National Institute of Health. And Candace was thrown out. But she wrote a book. She wrote a beautiful book. Please read this book. Molecules of Emotion. What's the book? Molecules of Emotion. Candace Pert. P-E-R-T. C-A-N-D-A-C-E. And Candace writes in this book so beautifully. Time has come for us now not to reach to a tablet counter when you have a headache, but to sit in a quiet place in your own house, meditate for a little while, and elevate your consciousness, and tell yourself their headache will go, and the headache will go. This is called quantum healing. There's a beautiful book written by one Indian professor of physics in America. It's called Quantum Doctor. Please read that book. Quantum Doctor is a great professor. Probably Soporkar may know him. His name is, what's his name? Goswami. Amit Goswami. Amit Goswami is professor of quantum physics in the University of Eugene in, what is that place called? Oregon. And Amit is a very nice man. Amit has written a beautiful book. And Amit was nominated for Nobel 3 times but didn't get the Nobel Prize. Amit was the one who started that CERN reactor thing in France. Millions of dollars are spent there. Now Amit says it's a foolish thing because there are no particles at all. Why continue that? But people want to continue there because there is a big research grant. It's a joke. Western research is a joke. I wrote a letter to Abdul Kalam. Why send a man to moon? 100,000 crores of Indian money. We have 45 million Indian children who do not have more than one, not even one meal. They are suffering from a disease called NIDS. Have you heard of NIDS? You all heard of AIDS, right? Did you know AIDS and the HIV virus has nothing in it common? No? No? Other dentists, you think AIDS na? Very interesting. This is created for making money to sell Zadovudine. Read this book as a dentist. Inventing the AIDS virus. Aya. Written by Peter Duesberg. P-E-T-E-R. Duesberg. D-U-E-S-B-E-R-G. He's professor of virology in the Berkeley University. And this book has a foreword by a Nobel laureate who was the father of PCR test. What's his name? PCR test. Huh? What's the name? Carrie Mullis. And Carrie writes, Peter and I don't know what causes AIDS, but there's no cause for AIDS. But Peter and I know one thing for certain, which nobody can dispute because he is the best virologist in the world, having got the Genius of the Century Award. And I am the father of the PCR test, which identifies viruses. Nobody can dispute. And Peter and I do not think HIV virus has anything to do with AIDS. Full stop. Unquote. But you and I believe. See, this is what we are. You and I are made to believe in wrong things for the sake of what is called? Wall Street greed. Manslayabale. Wall Street greed. But my happiness is I love that man, Creek. Because I have been saying that modern medicine has oversold itself and it is coming near its end. It's almost at its end. And that's why in the West there is a craze for alternate medicines. Would you know the budget of Europe's last year's alternate medicine? $70 billion. Is it music to the ears of Ayurveda people? $70 billion. There's so much a movement of Ayurveda today. 4 months ago, I was in Germany for an Ayurvedic conference of Europe. Again, in June, they have invited me to London for another meeting. See, there's a thick movement. Universities are interested. People are interested in Ayurveda because they have almost seen the horizon of Western medicine, non-scientific medicine, using linear mathematics as the base. And linear mathematics cannot be the base of modern science of human beings because human being is non-linear. Universe is non-linear. And quantum physics now says non-locality, things happen elsewhere. Supposing I am thinking about my friend in London now, some photons of mine will be acting on that man and you wouldn't believe it happens, you know. You seriously think. Yesterday I finished my thing. I reached my room at 7:55. I just opened my door, my phone rings. And this man says, you must have finished your meeting. You must have come back. I just wanted to say hello to you. Can you believe that? Honest to God. He's about 85-year-old man called Linus. He's such a nice man. He's my friend. And he has to call me wherever I am in the world twice a day. And he knows to call me when I am in my room. That's the interesting part of it. He exactly knows. This is called non-locality. And non-locality was condemned by Einstein. He said, oh, can't happen. Everything must happen here in my laboratory. Locality. Non-locality. What do you mean? Is God playing dice with the world? Einstein asked. Today he should be ashamed. Because today even we know what's called transportation, teleportation. You can convey an idea at a distance without any telephone wire, without any, yes, what is that called, cell phone and things like that. Experiments showed that you can evoke a potential in a brain of a yogi or a mystic. You can electrically evoke a potential and tell the yogi, transmit this potential to all your shishyas. And would you believe the potential gets transferred to the brains of all your shishyas? There's a yogi, professor of physics in Stanford University called William Teller. William Teller can convey his idea to any matter. He will keep a glass of water here and say, he'll concentrate on that and say, let this water have pH of 4.5, pH of 4.5, pH of 4.5. After some time you take that water, pH of 4.5. You drink it, it's water, but the pH is 4.5. You know the pH of this water? RO, reverse osmosis water, slightly acidic. Be careful when you drink it. So if you want to drink it, put little lime in it and drink it so that it becomes alkaline. So you don't know what's happening in this world. You and I are taken for a ride. So friends, with all this background knowledge, now let me tell you, lifestyle change is the only future for your health. Your health is in your hands. It's not in anyone's hands. It's not in doctor's hands, medicine's hands, no. You don't know when once you get a disease, what will happen to you. The greatest neurosurgeon, one of the best neurosurgeons in America, an Indian boy, youngster, very interesting boy. He gets cancer at a young age, lung cancer. Boy who married an American girl, they were planning to have a child, and he gets a little cough and loses weight, and then writes a book. Book ada per endamane? Good. Good girl. Mola nalla mola. Pare. When breath becomes air, you must read that book. You will cry. He's the best boy. Best neurosurgeon. And he is supposed to be the best. And 5 universities wanted him as professor. But he chooses his own university, Stanford, and joins there. His wife is an internist. And they join. And then they choose the best cancer specialist in America. Because there, you know, Western says, you know, just Google it and they get the best cancer specialist. And this girl says, don't worry, your cancer has 3 treatments. 1, a tablet a day, 20 years life. If it fails, chemotherapy, 5 years of life. If it fails, radiation, surgery, another 5 years of life. So you have another 25 years of life, you can plan your family. Husband and wife plan for a child. And she becomes pregnant. Tablet fails, chemotherapy fails, cut the long story short, he dies. But before dying, he writes this book. This boy has done master's in English literature before going to the medical school in Yale And he's a fantastic English, I tell you. This is a book worth its weight in gold. When breath becomes air. What a beautiful thing. When breath becomes air is a poem written by Walt Whitman. And the same poem's title he takes for the book. And if you read that book, you know, this relying on doctors, medicines and things like that is like relying on the devil. You rely on yourself. You say, let me not get cancer. If I get cancer, God only can help. I mean, if money can do and treatment, Jayalalitha would have died. Would she have died? She shouldn't have died. Because she can command anything in the world. But then, it has limitations. That is why, don't get into a situation where you go into that, what is called the mortuary, pre-mortuary. That is intensive care unit. Ultimate destination is a mortuary. But before that, you go through the intensive care unit so that you drain yourself of all the your savings and your other things. So, lifestyle. What a beautiful saying. Very simple, very simple. Eat half of what you want to eat. Supposing you want to eat 4 idlis, stop at 2 idlis. You will live probably another 20 years longer. Studies showed rats fed full stomach lived half the time of rats just fed half stomach. Can you believe that? So stop when you think you can eat equal amount. And eat in moderation and don't have any restrictions. Well, who told you must have a breakfast in the morning, a lunch in the afternoon and evening? Nothing. Whenever you feel hungry, you eat something. When you don't feel hungry, don't eat nothing. So eating at, you know, in the olden days, one pediatrician killed a lot of children in America. He said, time feed a child. You know, 2 o'clock, breastfeeding, 3 o'clock, something else, 4 o'clock, something else. Then when a lot of children died, he said, I'm sorry. Child knows when it wants food. It cries. Feed it. Don't overload it. There are even now Western aping Indian mothers who feed by the clock. Don't do that. You also don't do that. But one good advice which I gave yesterday is good. Don't eat after the sundown. These Jains, you know, the Jithen and all, they don't eat after sundown. They call it as palahara. That means they eat everything other than rice. That's Hello, na? That's what happens. But anyway, we had a lot of good ideas. Don't eat. Number 2, help as many people as you can. Each time you help somebody, that fellow will not be grateful to you. Forget it. He'll be ungrateful to you. But you are benefiting yourself. Because your body is built in such a way that paropakarartham idam shariram. You are here for others. And so try to do good to everybody. But the minute you do some good to somebody, follow Jesus. Let not the right hand know what the left hand does. Forget. And if you forget, you're happy. If you don't forget, and if you say, okay, I help B.M. Hegde. And when B.M. Hegde harms you, you feel terribly bad. And there was Ashutosh Mukherjee was a great teacher in West Bengal. He was told one day, by, you know, he was an old man, somebody said, see, so-and-so was bad-mouthing you so badly. Then he smiled. Here, I am telling you the truth. Why are you smiling? He smiled and said, no, I am only thinking, when did I help him? Because if you don't help somebody, they won't badmouth you. So you forget. But help, you must. You must go out of your way to help sometime. Because it helps you. Because he is you. Remember that? We, you and I are just leptoquarks. He is a leptoquark. And the same leptoquark exchanges between you and him. And you have the same consciousness and same mind. And his mind and your mind are connected. So if you help someone else or someone else helps you, he or she gets the benefit out of it. And that's the next thing that you do. Ayurveda is so good. Nitya, hita, mita, ahara, sevi. In moderation, what you like. A lot of people say, you'll sit down there and say, does it have cholesterol? Does it have this, that? That itself will give you blood pressure. Whether it is cholesterol or poison, you eat it, finished. And this eating that we have been doing, our ancestors have been doing, has come by what's called observational research. Why didn't people eat some poisonous fruit? They have seen over thousands of years that eating that fruit will kill you. And how did we choose? Who told you to eat rice? Who told you to eat wheat? Like, for example, why do you eat potato and sweet potato? Solanaceae plants are there in the wild for 500 varieties, but only two varieties you eat. The rest of them are all poisonous. So we are so lucky. There's so much research in the past. Today's research is what? Measuring things. Do you know what it's called, the Western research called? Fish net hypothesis. How many of you know what is fish net hypothesis? Really? John von Neumann is a great Hungarian-born American chemist who got the Nobel Prize for chemistry. He said, fish net hypothesis. Ichthyologists, you know, fishes. These fishes went to the sea to study fish. So they caught fish, came back to the laboratory, used a vernier caliper, measured everything up and down and said, one conclusion. What's the hypothesis? All sea fish are bigger than 2 inches in length. That became a proposal. It became hypothesis, then became thesis, and then became a theory. That's how science is. You know what is thesis? I asked a lot of these PhD students in the exam, I said, what is thesis? Thesis, sir, is writing about, sir, this is a dissertation, sir, it's this, sir. But what is the meaning of the word thesis? Thesis, sir, thesis. This is how we study in our schools. Just a mug up. Do you know what thesis is? Thesis is a table in the king's court in the olden days. So if you have a theory or if you have a proposal, if the king accepts it, you can keep it on the table. That's called thesis. Today, there's PhD. And if it can't be kept there and the king rejects it, you keep it under. It's called hypothesis. That's the truth. But how many PhD students know the etymological meaning of the word thesis? That's the problem. Anyway, come back. Then what happened? After some time, another group of ichthyologists went to the sea and they caught fish. Their fish had a smaller net hole, so even 1-inch fish were caught. So their hypothesis said, 1-inch also can be sea fish. So another thesis. So the present science of the West, only 5 senses. And these 5 senses measure whatever they measure at the given time. And that's called the final word. Which is not. And if you go with a smaller net to the sea, you can get 1/2 inch fish also. It's called fish net hypothesis. Please go and read that fish net hypothesis. Read a little more and then you get what all things happen in this world, you just don't know. This world is not what you see. Remember that? So the man who got the Nobel Prize and the alternate Nobel Prize and wrote about what is called the real a-duality says this world is Wirklichkeit. Wirklichkeit in German means drama. And he says it is Maya, Shankara's Maya. So beautiful. And that's the world is what not what you see. It is something else. But you are made to believe in something else, which is called advertisement. You know what is advertisement? You don't know. 1954, John Kenneth Galbraith, who was the American ambassador in India in the 50s before you were born. This fellow was 7'2". So when Pandit Nehru and he were walking, Pandit Nehru had to look like that, to look at him. Pandit Nehru himself was tall, but this fellow was 7'2". This fellow was a professor of economics in Harvard. He wrote a book in 1954 called Affluent Society, where he says, advertisement is not to tell the truth about the product to the community. It is about make them, entice them to buy that product when they don't even need it. For example, you go to a mall, M-A-L-L, 2 shirts for 1 shirt's price. The wife becomes greedy. She says, you better buy the 2 shirts now because you won't get it later. This fellow doesn't need shirts. He has enough shirts at home. But she says, no, see, it's cheaper now. Buy it. So the shirt is sold. And what that mall has done, for 2 shirt's price, their 1 shirt price has become. So they have not lost anything. But you become an ass that you bought the shirts when you don't need them. This is called advertisement. Same thing about medicine now. In the olden days, when we were all students, we took an oath, Hippocratic oath, and became hypocrites after that. But then Hippocratic Oath says you should not even have a board longer than 1.5 feet and 1 foot long. You should not advertise yourself. Today, my God, photograph of a doctor. The best cardiac surgeon in the world is standing here in XYZ for corporate hospital. Finished. That is not good. Because people should not go by that to get a cardiac surgery done. And when you go to meet your maker, then you can't discuss and say, oh, I did a mistake. I went to the wrong place because of advertisement. Right? So that is what is Nitya Hita Mita Ahara Sevi. Samikshakari. Work very hard. You must have seen our ancestors. Oh my God. I had a grandfather who lived up to 102. His fellow used to work even when he was 100. He used to go out. And he has to go to the court every day. With a lot of lands and everything. One day, you know, when he was about 100, his children said, you can't now go to the court. So they restricted him from going to the court. And the day he was restricted, he was feeling bad. And he felt bad and felt bad. Died within a year. Otherwise, he would have lived long. Probably he would have lived for another 10 years. He wanted to do what he wanted to do. We didn't allow him to do that. Samikshakari. Then what does it say? Data. Data. Be a giver, not a taker. We are all takers. I'm looking forward. What will they now, the IADK give me? What will they give me? And things. No. Be a giver. Give something to others. Data. Samaha. You know, you must look after everybody. Same way. A lot of us have this bad habit. If when you talk to the big president, hello sir, Jiten sir. Supposing the peon is there, hey, come here. No, no. You know, when I was a dean, a lot of these, you know, medical college and dental college and all, love affairs are very common. So when she loves a boy and then after some time she'll come to me and say, sir, please give me some advice, sir. I want to marry Jiten sir and my friends. How do you think he's a good boy or not? So I tell them, look, I can give you ideas about Jiten between 9 a.m. and 5 p.m. Between 5 p.m. and 9 a.m., what he does, I wouldn't know. So don't ask me. Take Jiten for an evening date. Take him to a restaurant and observe how he behaves with human beings. When he goes there, the restaurant chief comes there and says, hello, sir, how are you today? How are you doing? Hello, sir. And then he goes near the table where you both sit and there's little dirt there. Then he calls that boy, hey, come here, clean this. Don't marry him. He is not an honest man. He treats different people differently. And that's for not good for health. Samaha, samaha. Then satyapara. See, you imagine for a minute, telling a lie is very stressful. Supposing I have to tell a lie, I must remember that every day. Because next time somebody asks, the same lie must come, no? So that is a terrible stress. Telling a lie raises your blood pressure, your heart rate. Tell the truth. It's the same truth anyway, you know, wherever you are. What is there in it? It must be an open book. You shouldn't have any two things, you know, inside one, outside one. Same thing. Fine. Tell the truth. Satyapara. Kshamavan. You can do all these things, but others can come and slap you on the face. Forgive him. Poor man, he doesn't know. He knows not what he knows not. So forgive him. Shun him. Don't forgive him. Forgiveness, I tell you, is the greatest stress buster. And forgiveness, a lot of people come to me with ulcers in the mouth. You know? After ulcers, they have taken B complex after B complex after B complex. Then even the dental surgeons give them steroid ointments, etc., etc. I tell them, forgive. Make a list of people you hate. Forgive them. After ulcers simply disappear. Simply disappear. You just see that. You'll be surprised. I tell them, don't even tell your husband or wife. Close your room and make a list of people you hate. Simply make a list of people you hate. And then make an effort. Sit and meditate and say, I forgive B.M. Hegde. After all, he's an ass. Let him go to hell. Just see. You relax. After cells is gone. Blood pressure gone. Migraine gone. Autoimmunity is gone. Kshamavan. Then what does it say? Aptopasevi bhavet arogyam. Don't treat just your husband and wife as yours. Everybody is mine. Everybody is mine. He's my uncle, my aunt, my niece, my nephew, my grandfather, whatever it is. You just treat everyone as your equal and your blood pressure will come down. Your cancer will disappear. Did you know that? Your cancer will disappear. Now, friends, something more about lifestyle. Today, science tells us that you and I are not solid. We are just liquid or energy. Now, when you are energy, the matter changes into energy and energy changes into matter 1024 times in a second. In a second. And remember, each time the energy knows the blueprint of the matter. So, supposing, let us say, I have a problem in the eye, I was telling my friend. I can sit and meditate. And then I say, let my eye come back to its normal shape. Let my eye come back to its normal position. Let my eye come back. And next time when the matter becomes, energy becomes matter, let it correct it. Keep on doing that. This is called auto-suggestion. And this is called quantum healing. And lo and behold, your eyes get better. And people have now shown that you can sort of quantum heal anything. And please read that book, Amit Goswami's book, Quantum Doctor. And you as a doctor will get a lot of benefit because you can help your patients do that. There are a lot of things you can't cure, but you can. I'll give you another book, Anatomy of an Illness. Read that book, Anatomy of an Illness. Small book, written by Norman Cousins, a very famous American journalist. This fellow went to cover Kennedy-Khrushchev meeting in the 60s to Moscow in December. And they were standing in the tarmac. A jet was turning itself. In the sub-minus 40 degrees centigrade cold, the jet hit him so hard that he fell down. And some peculiar pain started in his body. He was admitted in Moscow hospital, then transferred to Boston to Harvard Medical School Hospital, where they made a diagnosis of ankylosing spondylitis. There's no treatment for that. You become stiff like a wooden log and then die. And they told him he will live for 3 months and they gave him a room and said, enjoy here because you are a very famous journalist. You die in Harvard Hospital itself. So he's lying there. He's resigned to his fate saying that he's going to die. All of his friends used to come and talk and talk. And one day somebody came and joked, really joked. And this fellow laughed for the first time. He laughed. Heartily he laughed. Norman Cousins laughed. And then he found his finger was moving. When he laughed, the finger moved. So his friend said, we must make him laugh all the time. Those days no television. So they brought this 8mm, that gudu 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 machine. In the olden days when you were born, they probably went to the cinema theater. It gudu 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 and then it stops and another gudu gudu gudu, it starts. Yeah. So this gudu gudu, all Charlie Chaplin and all movies, they came. He laughed and laughed and laughed and laughed. Walked out to Harvard Hospital after 3 months. And remained alive for 20 more years to write this book to tell you how laughter can cure you. Just stress busters, that's all. What's the book name? Anatomy of an Illness. Illness. What's the author's name? Norman, N-O-R-M-A-N. Cousins, C-O-U-S-I-N-S. You read that book. As doctors, as dentists. Now, don't have a classification of doctors. Today, quantum physics says tooth is a part of the body. You will be surprised. You started with one cell that included the tooth also. It didn't come separately. The implantology, it came. No, it didn't come. The tooth also originated from the one cell. And this cell divides, but divides in a peculiar way. That's the most important thing. Mark these words. It doesn't completely divide. There's a partial septum which comes and one becomes two. Partial septum comes, two becomes four. And then it becomes 120 trillion cells. But they're all interconnected. It's called a syncytium. And very interestingly, unlike what we have, that organ-based thing, two brain cells may not have the same genome. A brain cell and a heart cell can have the same genome. A brain cell and a kidney cell can have the same genome. A brain cell and a gum cell can have the same genome. A gum cell and a tooth cell can have the same genome. So you can reconstruct any organ from any other place. You can even reconstruct a tooth. You can reconstruct a gum by quantum healing. And don't you call yourself a dental surgeon, because you can't deal with only one organ. The organ specialization is gone. And you are a human body healer. Call yourself a healer or a doctor if you like. I'm afraid to call myself a doctor, because if you know the meaning of the word doctor, you will be afraid to call yourself. Doctor comes from dossier. Dossier is to teach. A doctor doesn't become a teacher. Who is a teacher? Teacher is an example for students. A doctor should be an example to society. And a great responsibility, mind you. You can't monkey around being a doctor. You must be an ideal human being. And very difficult. So I don't call myself a doctor. I call myself just a professor as of a teacher. That's all. And actually, this girl was saying, Professor Dr. B.M. Hegde, there's nothing in the English. The convention in London University is when you become a professor in the university, you lose your other tags, you become Professor so-and-so. Or supposing you become a surgeon in London, you call him Mr. so-and-so. And if you're a woman, you're called Miss so-and-so. So then after that, there's no doctor there. So it's just one of those things, you know, doctor is a very, very big thing. Actually, you know, great things, brainy fellows are called doctors. And they're all examples to society. And we should all try to be an example to society because society respects you. Society expects a lot of things from you. And society doesn't expect you to be a monkey and to be monkey around. So friends, very easy to heal yourself. Quantum healing has come to stay. And this is, you know, you don't know, you know, we don't know what's happening in this world. We as a team, four of us, went to Brazil to investigate a man called John of God. Have anyone heard of him, John of God? You heard of him? You raised your hand. No. John of God is a villager, farmer. One fine morning he had a vision from God saying that you have power to heal. So he started healing people, left, right and center. And people slowly, it's a small little village. Today it has become a huge town. Huge town. And you go there, you see a lot of these crutches, wheelchairs and are left there by people who came in wheelchair, went back walking. And we photographed him with five cameras in different places, seeing him operate on a breast cancer. The man comes, a villager, doesn't even wash his hands. He stands there and then prays for a long time. And then picks up his knife on the table, bread knife, and holds the breast like that and puts an incision. No blood comes out. He puts his hand inside the breast and squeezes that thing out. And then puts the breast there, hand there, and prays. Takes it out, no scar also. Can you believe that? You won't believe that. But I can tell you, I have got photographs of that. And you must see the thousands of people who flock there and go back happy. A lot of things you and I don't know. The world is very wide. And we have to know a lot. And what we know, what I know about this world is not even 0.0001% of what is to be known. Hell of a lot to be known. And that makes you humble, humble, humble. Humility is education, says India's system. Vidya dadati vinayaha, vidya vinaya sampanna. The greatest degree is how humble you are in this world. You are the educated man. How arrogant you are, irrespective of what A, B, C, D you have after your name, it couldn't matter. You are nobody. Humility says, look, I am yet to know a lot. And I have to know a lot. And that really stimulates you to know a lot. So friends, only thing that helps you to live is your lifestyle. Lifestyle. Work very hard. Eat less, talk the truth, help others, you live. Didn't you understand that? Very easy. And all diseases start in the mind and all diseases die in the mind. Krodha, shokha, bhaya, ayasa, viruddha anna bhojana, taponalan, katva, amla, kshara, lavana, tikshnoshrati, rakta, pitta, prakopayat. All things come from the mind. And where is the mind? Never mind. You are the mind. You don't have a body. What you call as a body is an illusion of the human mind. And the human mind is not in the brain. Every organ has a memory. Recently, my friend in London did a transplant, Magdi Yaqub, a very famous cardiac surgeon. And Magdi, when he did an operation from a 19-year-old boy who met with an accident and took the heart to a 56-year-old man who had intractable heart failure. Everything went smooth. But one thing happened. This man who recipient was a pure vegetarian. But after the transplant, he wanted only chicken in the morning, chicken in the afternoon, and probably fish in the evening, and beef in the morning. So everybody surprised what happened. Then they went back the history of the boy who met with an accident. He wanted chicken in the morning, chicken in the afternoon, chicken at night. And this vegetarian has become anti-vegetarian. So organs also are human beings. And they have the same creature. The mind is everywhere. So mind is not confined to a part of the body. Now, I will stop here. You know why? In all these things, we should have a cafeteria approach, not a camp approach. In a camp approach, everybody gets the same thing, rice kanji in the morning and pickles. But in the cafeteria approach, you can get masala dosa, you can get, if you want masala dosa, you want vada, you want anything you want. So now, if individually you have any problem about lifestyle change or your own problem, you don't say it's yours. You say, my neighbor has this problem. Ask a question. If I know the answer, I'll answer it. Thank you very much.
Good morning, doctor.
Good morning. Sit down and talk.
It's okay. I wanted to know if there's any way you can control allergy.
Good question.
I mean, I've seen a lot of people suffer very badly because of allergy. And if there's any treatment, I'm sure medicine is not a solution, but some holistic
good.
Way to treat. Yeah?
Very good. Very
Thank
good.
You.
Do you know what allergy is? The definition of allergy, I'll tell you. Fon Pirke is a French physician who defined allergy about 100 years ago. He said, altered, acquired capacity to react. You understand that? Altered, acquired capacity to react. So allergy is not genetic. Allergy is not something with you. You alter yourself one day to become allergic to something. You know, if you would have been eating, let's say, pickles every day, one fine morning you may be allergic to pickle. Unless you come in contact with pickle earlier, you will never be allergic. Even drugs like that. Unless you are exposed to a drug, like penicillin allergy, for example. Penicillium notatum is a fungus in the wild. All of us can come in contact with that. Somebody suddenly becomes allergic. So it's altered. And the most important part of allergy is the mind. So half the allergy, if not more than whole the allergy, can be really eliminated if you analyze your mind and forget about the whole thing. You fuss about it, you become more allergic. Acute allergy, Stevens-Johnson syndrome or acute collapse, requires treatment. Temporarily, steroids. Steroids, nothing. It's just one of those placebos that you give to everybody for everything. But taking medicines in the chronic for allergy, on a chronic basis, is very dangerous because most of these anti-allergy drugs, which are called anti-allergy drugs, are very bad H1 blockers. And they invariably increase the QT interval in the heart. And one of the quick methods of killing yourself very fast is being on anti-allergic drugs continuously. Some of the recent anti-allergic like cinnarizine are H1 blockers plus A1 blockers so that your blood pressure goes down sometimes. So be careful when you do these things. And second thing is, no doctor tells you, or many doctors forget to tell a man, anti-allergy drug people should not drive a vehicle. But they suddenly, their level of thinking will go down and the judgment goes down and accidents are very common. It is estimated that 50% of the road accidents are due to people taking anti-allergic drugs without their knowing that. And one of the methods of anti-allergy thing is how to change the mind. Quantum healing. Meditate and get it out. And the nose allergy, the seat of the allergy is in the submucosal layer. Now there are lasers which can remove that layer and sensitize that layer, desensitize layer, and you are all right in no time.
I believe that most of our diseases, such as cancer and stuff, is caused by some kind of stress, emotional, mental. But that doesn't help explain why four-year-olds get blood cancer and things like that. How do children
get beautiful cancer? Question. This girl is very good. I like that girl. Amma, have you got into a four-year-old child's mind?
I've tried to. A lot.
Yeah,
of
you have not been. You will see a two-year-old child, when you get the next child coming out, it hates that child so much that it wishes the child can be killed. They have tried to kill that. They are also in the same world, ma. They have also got emotions, which you and I don't understand. They are also same zygote as you and I are. And they also can think. So you don't know what happens. You know, a lot of people ask, why did Ramana Maharshi die at a young age? Why did Shankara die at an young age? How do you know they had a tranquil mind? They were good people. You know, for example, you think I am a good man. I may be a rascal inside. You don't know. You don't know, really. So a child also has emotions. So a 4-year-old child can have cancer. Nothing wrong in it.
You will be surprised to know that your child learns in your own womb. Did you know that?
Yes.
If you and your husband fight when you are having the child inside, that child becomes a fighter when it comes out. It can learn for, you know, 9 years, for 5 years in the house, surroundings.
Kurukshetra.
So, Kurukshetra. See how that Chakravuha coming out and going in, etc. Today people are teaching mathematics to children in the womb. Yeah, you can do that. You just try this experiment. You, when you become next pregnant, or your somebody friend becomes pregnant, after some time you name the child. You name the child something and call the child every day. And after a few months, you just simply call the child, it moves in the tummy.
Professor, I've tried that. I have a 12-year-old son who loves mathematics. And I remember when my friends used to ask me when I was pregnant, if I have any kind of urges to eat, you know, we have specific urges to eat. And I had none. But I used to want to solve integral calculus, you know, enjoyed doing that. And my son loves mathematics.
Good girl. Good girl. Indians are good at calculus after Ramanujan, you know. You will be surprised. A professor of cardiovascular surgery in Stanford, such a big man. His name was David Eddy, D-A-V-I-D-E-D-D-D-Y. Eddy, at the age of 52, when he was about to become the head of the Department of Cardiac Surgery because his boss, Norman Shumway, was retiring, he said, why am I doing bypass surgery? It's unscientific. There's no scientific basis. I'm using linear mathematics and non-linear organ. He resigned his job. Can you believe that? 52, Stanford, professor of cardiovascular surgery, resigning his job. And he joins Stanford University for PhD in mathematics. 3 years later, he gets a PhD in mathematics with the Henley Gold Medal. And a citation says, David was the best brain in calculus that Stanford had in 350 years. And David goes on to change the physiology of man. And he has got a new physiology now called www.archimedesmodel.com. Go to the library, put it there. You get and then put your problems there, you get a solution there. And you will find whatever drug you give there, it says it's horrible. Don't take that drug. And David is now professor of medical management in Stanford University. He doesn't do bypass surgery. So good.
Thank you.
Here, doctor.
Don't ask a difficult question.
I have a couple of questions.
My God.
One is, how do we get rid of the plaques in the arteries without statins, for example? And the second question is, if someone is detected with, say, 90% blockage or something, and having stent implanted is good or not?
good. Both questions are good. They are really good questions. You know what it shows? Are you an engineer? Yeah, see, how did I know? Because only an engineer can illogically think that if there is a block, that must be removed. There is a toilet block, it must be removed, no? If the toilet pipe is blocked, water to come, you put a new pipe. But unfortunately, the human body is non-linear and non-Euclidean, so you can't apply your Euclidean linear mathematics there. When the block starts as a child, God starts giving you bypasses. They are called collaterals. So it's good. It's good to have a block. Remember that? Don't try to remove the block. As a matter of fact, we have developed a new system of yoga where you can produce blocks in those rare individuals, unfortunately, who don't have block. I'll show you that. It's very simple. You know the sannyasis in the Himalayas live up to 100 years? You and I don't live. Do you know why? We have too much oxygen here. They have very little oxygen there, up there. So less oxygen means the heart gets to learn to live longer. So with the blocks coming, nature has given the block, the heart will live longer. So don't try to remove that. And whoever has told you that statin will remove the block must have told you or taken you up the golden path. Now this is a very simple exercise. This is very simple and it has two things it does. A, it helps your heart to have intermittent hypoxia. You know, every second, part of the second you don't get oxygen, the other half you get the oxygen. So heart gets stimulation. And it produces the blocks and helps the blocks. And very simple. And at the same time, it exercises a beautiful muscle called psoas major. It's a large muscle which starts in the chest at the back and comes down to the pelvis and holds on and comes and attaches itself to the thigh. So that if you stimulate this muscle, all the organs are stimulated every day in the human body. It's very simple. See, stand like this. Of course, now I've had a full breakfast. I shouldn't be doing it, but anyway, let me try. You should do it on empty stomach. You stand like this and then breathe in and breathe out. Breathe out, breathe out, breathe out, breathe out. Sit without a chair. Breathe out, breathe out, breathe out, breathe out. Stand up, breathe in, breathe in, breathe in. Now what have I done? I have breathed out for 20 seconds without oxygen going to my heart. And now breathing in. So intermittent hypoxia I have given. Number two, I have stimulated my psoas. If you did it 5 times in the morning, 5 times in the evening, your blocks will increase. You don't want that, right? And you will live longer.
How about the stent part?
I didn't want to answer that. Actually, the stent will worsen the whole thing.
Or a bypass surgery.
No, no. Both will worsen the whole thing. Now, you live after that because of the placebo effect. You shouldn't live after that. Actually, bypass surgery is associated with double the risk of heart attack afterwards. Quadruple the risk of stroke afterwards. Sudden death increases afterwards. Heart failure increases afterwards. Nobody tells you this. But your pain goes. Pain goes. Pain went without the surgery also, you know that? I gave you an example of placebo effect. Now you think medicines will cure you? I'll give you a study. It's a very interesting study, recently published. Published in one of the most prestigious journals called Science Translational Medicine, STM. And this was done in 4 universities, Oxford, Cambridge, Hamburg and Munich. Led from Oxford by Professor Bingel, who is the professor of medicine in Oxford. You can write down. You can write, I'll give you a reference. Good. You have a clerk also. Paid clerk or unpaid clerk?
I'm not the clerk, I'm the boss.
Yeah. I saw an American plaque which said, I am the boss of the house. I have permission of my wife to say so. Go on, tell. Write down. Bingel, B-I-N-G-E-L. Bingel. Et al in Latin means and others. There are so many authors. I can't tell you all of them. And this name is the placebo effect. Placebo effect. P-L-A-C-E-B-O effect. And the journal is STM, Science Translational Medicine. Year is 2011. Volume is 3. Page is 70. You read this, what they have done is, they did a study of morphia. You know morphia? Biggest painkiller. And they took severe pain patients, severe pain, the like of which you can't even imagine. And they ran a drip of morphia in their vein. Okay? But told the patient, this is not morphia. This is a new vitamin we have found out for your disease. Your pain won't go, but you will get better. 100% patients' pain didn't go. Can you believe that? What was running in their vein? Morphia. And the most powerful painkiller. Right? Then, what is called crossover study, they took the patient to another center. They ran salt water, saline, in the vein. And then said, this is the latest salt of morphia. Very powerful. Your pain will go. Pain went. Did you get that? That's the placebo effect. So, angioplasty, scientifically, is damaging the intima of the artery. You're breaking it and then attracting a clot. By evening, that is closed. Whether you have a stent or no stent, ordinary stent, desiccated stent, medicated stent, etc., is all for money, nothing else. And you get better because you're paid money. Placebo effect. Today, the greatest cause of a stroke is not having diabetes or hypertension. Going to a hospital with bypass facilities after chest pain is the biggest risk for stroke. 50% of them get a stroke after bypass surgery. 97% of them get multiple emboli and the cognitive defect, which settles down to 47%. They don't know, they forget so many things. They don't, sometimes they forget their boss's name, etc. You get the point? But this is not known, no? This world is worklich geht. Do you know how bypass surgery started? You don't know. And how it became a business? You don't know. If you knew, you wouldn't have bypass surgery. It is not how I knew you were an engineer. I knew because a lot of people do this. This one man called Subramanya Swami. Have you heard of him? Some years ago, he came to me. Somebody brought him to me with some chest pain, which was, of course, little. So I examined him and said, look, nothing to worry. You're stressed so much, you know, go slow. That was the time he was contesting for the parliament from Madurai. And he said, what are you talking, doctor? This is a block. And I am an economist. I am a professor of economics in Harvard. I said, that's the problem. That's the problem. No, there is a block. It was removed, like you. Then I told him, it's not like that, Mr. Swami. You know, I told, explained to him, he wasted so much of my time. All free, you know, because these politicians, they don't pay. But he would have paid. If I had asked, he would have paid. I didn't ask. Anyway, he went and had an angioplasty. After that, saw a lot of problems here. Now he's all right. Because nothing happens to these people. Nature looks after them. So I do this yoga technique for some children, unfortunate children who don't get blocks. And they develop blocks. Or even without the block, if you did every day this exercise, you get intermittent hypoxia for the heart. The heart lives longer. Now did you understand the difference between a dynamic structure which is non-linear and a non-linear structure which is the toilet pipe? Or probably you are in the oil company pipe. Oil company pipe is blocked.
Yeah, but you mean to say modern medicine is not good at all?
I never said that. Modern medical quick fixes are needed for an emergency care. But quick fix only. See, somebody, supposing I collapse now here. I can't sit and do yoga and I'll say I'll be all right. Okay? Supposing I fall under a motor car, I can't. You know, I fell under an auto rickshaw the other day. I survived by the skin of my teeth. I thank the auto rickshaw fellow for saving my life. This fellow was dead drunk at 5 o'clock in the evening. I was going for a walk on the footpath. This fellow swerved the rickshaw because he wanted to avoid a bus and came right onto me and hit me. If you look at my leg, you will get shocked. You will not come to Kuwait. But I told Jitin I am coming, so I came. And this, because see, this is, now I can't say I will do yoga and get it right. No. You have to do something. But I didn't do anything. But what I'm saying is modern medicine has a certain role. But the percentage of people who benefit by that is 1% of the sick population. 99% of the sick population do not require modern medicine. It is used for money. I'll give you an example. One example will do. 55 million people in Europe do not go to work in winter because of what's called feverish cold. Simple disease. Feverish cold. 55 million. Now these people don't require modern medicine. Do you know what they require? A good dose of ginger, garlic and pepper. And they'll be fine. Next day they can go back to work. What do we do today? We give antibiotics to them. Send them home. If you give antibiotics to a viral disease, your immune system changes and the immune cytokine response becomes Th1 to Th2. And most of the Th2s are either vasoconstrictors or bronchoconstrictors. So by giving antibiotics to a viral disease, we produce, manufacture asthma. Is it good? Or we manufacture a heart attack in elderly people. See? Do you know the amount of people who die of nosocomial infection in the intensive care units? We created that, thanks to antibiotics. So what I'm trying to tell you is, we have a judicious mix of these things. Simple things can do that. A study in Canada showed when a doctor sees a heart attack in society, he will have seen 36,000 minor illness syndromes. There are 4 minor illness syndromes, which we don't even teach in medical college properly. Common cold, feverish cold, flu-like illness, and then sore throat. Simple things. Now a doctor doesn't know the difference. How many doctors can tell the difference between common cold and feverish cold? How many doctors know that the best treatment for sore throat is hot water? How many of us give antibiotics for a sore throat? This is the problem of modern medicine. I didn't want to go into that because, you know, all that, it'll be a big another medical college class. Difficult. But if you're interested, there's a book I have written, What Doctors Don't Get to Study in Medical School. Read that book. This book was so badly condemned when it came out in India. They wrote, this is a rubbish book and this fellow is a mad fellow. His English is not good. Book is not good. Blah, 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 blah. And the book sold, all the copies were sold in 1 week's time, thanks to that review. Then it got published in London. And the British Medical Journal's editor wrote, this is not a textbook as claimed by the author, but certainly in my opinion, this is a holy text of medicine written by a prophet. It is still going on in the fifth edition. And Amazon is making sometimes money when it's short supply. They say $900 for it. It's 245 rupees in India. It is selling. So these things happen. This is how commercial things. So my son sells that book in America for the same, some $20 or something like that. And through Amazon, he sells it.
Is he a doctor?
No. That's the good thing. My doctor daughters don't believe me. He's an engineer like you.
Doctor. Yes, sir. Thank you, doctor.
Doctor, here. Dr. Hegde, thank you very much for your enlightening speech. I would like to ask you about... I'd like to ask you about antidepressants for a long time and their benefits, if any. And I know that you are...
What a beautiful question.
Yes.
You couldn't have asked a better question. This is a million-dollar question.
Thank you.
Let me tell you something. When the mind is not in the brain, how can you treat depression with chemicals? Do you know what happens when you treat depression with chemicals? You become demented. And that's called Alzheimer's disease. One professor of neurology, I mean psychiatry, in New York, this girl wrote a book. Her name is Grace Elizabeth Jackson. What's her name? Write down. Grace Elizabeth Jackson. And the book says, Dementia, a drug-induced crime on mankind. Dementia, a drug-induced crime on mankind. Okay? And this book is selling like hotcakes and she has made millions. But she has been dismissed as a professor of psychiatry in the New York University because of writing that book. Please read Grace Elizabeth Jackson's book and it will tell you. It's a very nice book. It goes into the chemistry of it. I mean, when the mind is not there, the best treatment for depression is social support, behavioral therapy, group therapy. Patients come out of it. You know what happens when you take drugs for depression on a long-term basis? The patient commits suicide. One of the side effects of antidepressant drugs is it stimulates the brain to commit suicide. Now, most of the crimes, even homicides, are due to taking antidepressant drugs. I won't go further into it. One example is German Wings plane was taken down by the co-pilot because he was on a heavy dose of antidepressants. I mean, go on and on and on. But that's a beautiful question. As a matter of fact, there is no scientific basis for treating mental illnesses with chemical drugs. For mental illnesses, only psychotherapy. For a mind which is not at ease, another mind at ease must set it in ease. Not a chemical molecule. Yes, sir.
Doctor, most of the people now suffer from the diabetic.
That's a wrong statement. Incidence of diabetes genuinely has not gone up. But we are creating diabetes. So, for example, he's in his area. You give that chemical for depression. What is that called? Thallium. Produces diabetes. Our friend takes statin. 40% of statin taking patients become diabetics in 1 year. So are we not manufacturing a lot of diabetes? I mean, of course, we are producing obesity, which is one of the important causes of diabetes. Obesity is very rampant in the West. Even in this country, I see almost every other person is obese.
If at all the person already got diabetic, what is the solution? Without medicine, whether they can cure? That is
very good question. Very good question. As a matter of fact, if you can control your diabetes without medicine, you will live 10 years longer than a non-diabetic. Did you know that? The study, beautiful study, Indian study, which shows that if you control your diabetes without drugs, diabetes can be easily controlled without drugs. Diet and exercise. 1 hour walking, 350 calories gone. 350 calories is 7 idlis. 1 idli is 50 calories, 7 idlis is 350 calories. So you walk one day, one hour, so 350 calories gone. It's like, you know, bank balance. You put more money, put less money inside and spend more money.
there's less balance. Are you an economist? You're a doctor?
Chartered accountant.
Chartered accountant. See, that's why I said that. How did I know you're a chartered accountant? You put less money in the bank, spend more money. So balance is less, isn't it? See, chartered accountant, bright chartered accountant. See, how did I know? Good man. Walk, walk, walk.
Thank you, doctor. Thank you.
And relax, relax, relax. More tension, you want this, you want that. Chartered accountant, then, you know, especially if you're a chartered accountant accounting the Ravana account, then your blood pressure, blood sugar will go up.
Hello, sir. Here.
Yes, young lady. Huh?
What about hyperlipidemia? What is the treatment you would suggest?
Amma, there isn't anything called hyperlipidemia. The more lipid in the body, the better for you. You live longer. We created a myth called fat is bad for the heart. There isn't any basis for that. Now, Americans are saying we are sorry for doing that. Now, you want USDA has put a 553-page document saying that Americans should eat more fat. They should at least have 2 eggs a day. And they should have more eggs and more green butter and more ghee and things like that. Who is this hyperlipidemia, the disease? It's a commercial disease. Why should you believe fat is bad? If you know, if you go back, it all started with the first study called Ansel case study. This man was given $100 million to study relation between fat and heart disease because already companies had drugs to lower fat. So this man created a study. He studied 22 countries and found there is no relationship at all. He can't write a no relationship having taken so much money. So he made a paper by eliminating country by country by country without telling any people how many countries he studied. He studied 22 countries, presented 6 countries and had some sort of a relationship. But there was this professor called John Yudkin in London in the 50s who had found out fat is very good for health and what was bad was sugar. So he wrote a book for you. You read that. You're an engineer, no? It's called Pure, White and Deadly. Have you seen that book? Pure, White and Deadly, John Yudkin. Now they demonized that man. They dismissed him, a professor of nutrition, London University. They removed his degree and they put him out of the GMC. And the poor fellow had to teach music to survive. And he has died. Now they say, oh yes, sugar lobby did this. And now it is found out for your information's sake as an engineer. The sugar lobby paid 3 Harvard scientists $50 million to create the fat myth. But luckily, all those 3 are dead now, so they can't be prosecuted. You understand now? Now why do you believe that? So don't believe anything. Go into it. Don't you believe anything. Don't believe what I say. Find out for yourself. Don't believe what I say about bypass surgery. Go and find out yourself. Then you know what's happening.
Hello, sir.
Professor, what we can learn from the nature, like animals, they have similar diseases?
Beautiful, beautiful.
And we have more diseases because we investigate more on us.
What a beautiful thing. Do you know what this is called? Disease mongering. We go after diseases and create diseases in human beings because we don't have what is called normal. We have average. These actuaries have taught us, the chartered accountants have taught us. There was an actuary like, what's your name, sir? Vishweshwar. There was a big Vishweshwar in London in the 18th century. His name was Benjamin Grumpets. What is his name? Benjamin Grumpets. This man had written the actuarial data of human death and disease in the 18th century. And everybody forgot about it. That is lost. Now they have discovered in the debris of his old house, in the 18th century house, the document. And they took it out and put it on the present actuarial statement. It fits in so beautifully. Nothing has changed. But we have created more diseases by what is called disease mongering. Supposing I am selling idlis in India. I want to say idli is very good for everybody, no? So if I am a doctor, I want more disease, no? You will be surprised in London. Doctors were very happy when the smallpox epidemic used to come in the 18th century. That's the time they make more money. And 1823, the doctors in London were so bad, for your information's sake, that a doctor among them called William Wakeley, W-A-K-E-L-E-Y, Wakeley thought
the London doctors of 18th century, I'm quoting his words, were a bunch of corrupt, impotent, nepotistic fools who have become an abscess on the human body like a pus. So he said, I'm going to teach them science and then I will see that they become better. And he started a journal which he called as the Lancet, knife, so that I'll remove the pus. When did Lancet start? 1823. Who started? James Wakely. Now how many years? 2316, 185 years. The present editor of Lancet last year, Richard Horton, said, what has been the effect of Lancet on the doctors? You want to know? Don't want to know? If you don't want to know, don't know. And he commissioned a Hilary Butler, a journalist from New Zealand, to do the study. She studied and wrote, I quote, what was once a bunch of corrupt, impotistic, nepotistic fools has transformed itself into a corporate monstrosity which is cutting people left, right and center all over the world. You want to know?
Hello, sir. I'm Vinayak here. I have one comment based on what you told today, that you are going back to again age-old what our saints taught in India. Like one of the saints I remember in Maharashtra was Samarth Ramdas. Like Mana Sajjana, he will say, like, oh mind, oh great mind, listen to your mind and do what is right and what is truth to be said. You are going back to that same old concept. I have one is this our Indian the doctors who were earlier, which were saints, is that we are going back to again that old era of the medication, which is the foundation of whole medicine in India? Is that you are pointing to holistic medicines? And another point I want to make is that how do I avoid negative persons? Like, there are a lot of negative people surrounding us who will influence us that you can't do this, you can't do that, you can't do that, do this only. So I just wanted to say two things, actually. Thanks.
Very good man. Very good man. The first thing you said is absolutely right. Knowledge does not belong to any particular era. Knowledge goes around in circles like fashion. You know, you are not old enough to know. There was a time when we were all young, the trousers were very wide here. Bell-bottom trousers. They become narrow, 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 narrow. They become very narrow. Now they have started becoming broader and broader and broader. Knowledge is, wisdom is like that. It goes around in circles. And I already told you, if you have not caught it, that I quoted Hans-Peter Dürer, who wrote a paper called Matter is Not Made Out of Matter, where he says, I learnt my science. Who is saying this? A nuclear scientist who was the director of Max Planck Institute in Munich, which is the highest body of physics, and in Germany. And he followed Einstein, Werner Heisenberg, and then he's the director now. And he has been the director for 20 years. And he says, I'm a nuclear scientist. My job is to look at matter at its subtlest level. And now, one day I found out there is no matter at all. Was I surprised? No. Because I have been reading Indian sages who said there is no matter at all. And they said it is Advaita, Tat, Sat. So do you think he is right or wrong? He, you and I have no concern for our hoary past. That doesn't mean we can live in the past. You got to progress. But you can take a lot of wisdom from the past. You are absolutely right. And there's a lot of difference between our tradition and the Western tradition of reductionist science. Our tradition is the whole science which is observational research. Thousands of years we have done the research. For example, are you from which part of India you are? So you're Bagalkot, Namurna. Already. See, a lot of people, especially Brahmins in India, before they eat, they do what's called achamanam. They yes. take some water around the leaf and then drink it. Now they thought you all think it is foolish. Superstition, old thing. Why should I do that? But if you know now physiology, there's a tube which takes food from the mouth to the stomach, which is called the esophagus. And this esophagus is a closed tube. It's potentially open, but it's closed. Supposing you go there and suddenly take a solid food, like you had two pegs of whiskey and then take a big meat piece in biryani, that will get stuck there because it won't open. And a lot of people have died. Now, this was observed by people over the years, and they said, if you put a little water, the esophagus starts this peristalsis, like the snake, starts the peristalsis.
Right.
They told people, do little water and then, drink it. Who bothers? If you tell people compliance, they brought God inside. And then God means fear. So, compliance. They said, if you do this, God will be happy. So, everybody did. Like that. So, less people died. Isn't that a good method?
Yes.
Why can't you learn from that?
Fear is the emotion which...
I'm not saying. Fear is just a byproduct. Yeah. What I'm saying is, the minute compliance goes up, people survive. They knew that.
Yes.
That's why they made this. Yes. So, it is not anything bad. Do you know you ring a bell in the temple?
Yes.
Do you know now sound waves kill germs?
Yes.
Temple is a place where a lot of people come, a lot of germs can be there, and germs like people crowding around in closed places. So all that is known, they knew that, and this will zap the germs. You know mantra chanting, the vibration that can kill germs? So all this is science, but we don't want to know that. We think modernity means it must come from the West. There's a wrong definition of modernity. Every modernity comes from its antiquity. So Western modernity came from Western antiquity. And Indian modernity should come from Indian antiquity and not from Western antiquity. Did you understand that?
Yes.
That's the difference.
Thanks.
Good. He's a good boy. I know him. Good boy. But he has become a businessman. That's the only problem. Have you seen his resort in San Diego? Oh, you must go there. It's a fascinating resort. You go there and stay there, $10,000 in a week. You just enjoy Deepak meal, Deepak this, Deepak that. And he's a lot of so-called, quote-unquote, Ayurvedic drugs. I told him, Deepak, you shouldn't be doing this Ayurvedic drug business. But that's his... And who are his clients? The big names in the Bollywood. So this fellow is... He has got a studio and apartment in Manhattan. So he flies to Manhattan every weekend and comes back, and then he enjoys life. But he's a good boy, and he has got writers to write the books. He writes the same thing again and again, Seeing God, this fellow, that fellow, and all. So many books are there. Good books. Good boy. He called me once for a lecture, and he interviewed me, which came in the television in America. He said, "Sir, what is wrong with modern medicine?" I said, "Everything is wrong." So it came, big thing, and people wanted to kill me. But then truth is bitter. Truth is bitter. Basis is wrong. We have to use non-linear mathematics in the human body and not linear mathematics. That's all the difference. Yes? Yes, ma?
I'm Dave. I would like to ask this question. Can music heal?
Oh, what a beautiful boy. I love you. Come here, come here, come here, come here, come, come. Music is a big therapy, man. Come here. You come. Music is a big therapy. Come here. Ah, what a lovely boy. My God, I like boys like this. Come here, come here, come. Ah, what a beautiful boy. What is your name?
Dave.
Dave. Ayurveda has a special subject called Gandharva Ayurveda, where for every illness there is a raga, there's a particular raga, and a man called some Malayali chap, very interesting chap, he has now analyzed that and he has put that in a CD which is being sold from Canada. And if you tell them what is your disease and what is your horoscope and a date of birth, etc., they'll find a raga for your disease. And you can buy the CD and listen to that. And this is now known that ragas can really heal. And as a matter of fact, a good music, if you listen to, your blood pressure comes down. Did you know that? We have done a lot of studies on music, blood pressure. But not rock music. There's a nice book written by an American professor called Closing of an American Mind. Young man, write down the book, Closing of an American Mind. His name is Alan Bloom. Alan teaches social philosophy in the Chicago University, a brilliant man. And Alan writes that all the ills of American society today in the 20s is due to the rock music of the 60s. And rock music, you know what the meaning of the word rock music? Anybody knows? Rock, 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 rock. Engineer sub. Chartered accountant sub. Rock, it's like a rock. Rock, 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 rock. Rock means sexual intercourse in African language. So the rock music beat is the sexual intercourse meat. So people who delve himself in rock music, they lose emotions in sex later on. So the epidemic of today's divorce in America is due to the 60s, ABBA, GIBA and all rock music. And then rock music robs you of the peace of mind. And then all kinds of problems come from that. Please read the book Closing of an American Mind by Alan Bloom. B-L-O-O-M-A-L-L-A-N. Alan Bloom. Good boy.
One more question.
Yeah.
Is playing and hearing music is a good lifestyle?
Good, good, good. Very good boy. Very good boy. Yes, yes, young dear. Yes, you are right. Music is good. You know, this actually you will be surprised. If you attend a music concert and enjoy that, your blood pressure, we have seen blood pressures coming down. You know, some of these, you know, especially Indian classical music, the alapana, so nice, so nice. You become so tranquil. The cultural capital of India is Chennai. And if you go now, December month, from the 15th of December to the end of December, there are 50 Gana Sabhas in one road. And they have music from morning till night, different musics, all big names. Karaikudi Mani, this fellow, that fellow, and all people sing there. And you would be surprised, you don't get a room in any hotel in Madras in December because all RNI, Chennaites, RNIs, they all flock there and listen to all that music and then go back to America or Timbuktu or wherever they are from, or Kuwait for that matter.
We will only have time to take two more questions.
Hello.
Good girl.
Hello, doctor.
Come.
Coming to the subject of preventive medicine,
We
who work in the corporate sector and have a very sedentary lifestyle, the only preventive medicine we know is going to India for an annual health checkup. And when we go there, they subject us to all kinds of tests and the readings, and we take that as gospel truth, and they suggest all kinds of medicines. What is your opinion on this annual health checkup?
Very good, very good. Do you know what I wrote to the bank chairman? I wrote to the bank chairman, do not give money for your people to go for a checkup. Give a bonus to people who don't go to see doctors at all and they're happy, and give them 1 or 2 lakhs every year and they live longer, your bank will benefit a lot. Otherwise, checkup. You know what is checkup? There are some tests, they run the whole test. And then you get some data, what is called result. And this data is not static. Supposing your sugar now, you know, we did some study. We pricked 5 fingers of a human being and took 5 blood samples. Within maybe a few seconds or minute maybe, the 5 are different. If they are different, he's a healthy person. Nothing will happen to him. Even if he's a diabetic and the 5 readings are different, he will not have any problem with the diabetes. But if the 5 are same, you are either going to die very soon or you are a very bad diabetic. Remember that? So there is what is called healthy chaos. Every lesion must be like this. Blood pressure must be like this. Sugar must be like this. It becomes like that only when you are dead. So if your doctor catches it there, he calls high blood pressure. Catches it here, he calls low blood pressure. I'll give you an example. What is the average height of an Indian male? This is a telling example I teach health people. I get fed up telling that. What we do is we do an actuarial thing. You take 1,000 people and then plot it on a Gaussian curve, bell-shaped curve. Engineers understand, actuaries understand. So there are people with 4.6 inches height, normal. 6.6 inches height, normal. Now what we do mean plus 2 standard deviation. This is a statistical term. What is statistics, do you know? Huh? Good boy. Who is that? Who said that? Good man. There's a nice book for you. It's called Statistics, Science Without Sense. That's the book's name. Science Without Sense. The author's name is Stephen Milloy, who teaches statistics in Washington State University. Very interesting thing. Anyway, now you get what? 5.4 inches plus minus 2 inches. Now let us say you go for a checkup. How tall are you?
6 feet.
6 feet. So he is abnormal. He is a disease. So the treatment they prescribe is cut his leg and make him 5.4. How tall is your wife?
5'10".
5'10", oh, she's also tall. Supposing you have a Jaya Bachchan-like wife, 4.6. And the treatment for her is transplant a leg and make her 5.6. This is what exactly is called, see. So preventive medicine is not the right term. Promotive medicine. The right thing is promotive medicine. Your company should tell you, or you should do, you'll change your lifestyle so that none of these things happen. Do you know what was Mahatma Gandhi's blood pressure? 200 by 100. Do you know who was not getting sleep? Sushila Nair, his doctor. And the old man was sleeping very comfortably and died of all complications of hypertension, including that goat says bullet. So your blood pressure is what is your blood pressure? It's not my blood pressure. And there is nothing called normal blood pressure because I don't know. I have been researching blood pressure for 40 years. I have written a book on blood pressure. If you ask me now, I don't know what is normal blood pressure. And if you ask me what is my blood pressure, I don't know.
Hello, doctor.
Hello, sir. Hello.
Good. Very good question. Portman Group of Alcohol Manufacturers created this myth in 1981. Which was published in the British Heart Journal in January issue of 1981, where the editor wrote, now the doctor should go to society and ask everybody to drink so that heart disease will come down. And the truth is, every drop of alcohol damages the heart muscle, which is called cardiomyopathy, and there's a bigger cause of death, sudden death, than heart attack. And this is why Gorbachev banned vodka, because 30 people were dying in the central hospital in Russia, every Moscow, every day, of alcoholic cardiomyopathy, cutting off the heart blood, the circulation of electricity. Mone, not even one drop. Is it moderation?
Hello, sir. One.
You must change your idea of moderation. Yes.
Hello. One quick question, sir.
Quick.
Yeah. As you said, most of the diseases are due to emotions and stresses. How do you explain these diseases due to genetic disorders? For example, retina pigmentosa.
Wait. There's a difference between congenital inherited diseases and genetics as a role call of cause of heart disease. Genes have no role to play in human life. Remember that? Genes have no role to play in human life. But there are some inherited diseases which are called genetic, which is not really genetic. All diseases, everything happens to man because of the environment. Genetics has gone. And human gene, if you want to know, human genome has only 23,000 human genes, 2.5 trillion germ genes. You have virinomes, metabolomes, germinomes, etc., etc. So that what your parents contribute to you is 23,000 divided by 2.5 trillion. Where's our actuary? It'll be 1 in a million chance. So 1 in a million chance sometimes you get retinal thing, or you get a congenital disease. That is not genetic. None of the diseases that we talk about and we treat are genetic. They are environmental. And that's why lifestyle change is the only thing. Genes don't matter. Epigenetics has come. Darwin was wrong. Lamarck is right. And Darwin's own grandfather, Erasmus Darwin, told him, you are wrong. But he didn't listen to that. But Darwin, while dying, he said, yes, environment is important. But neo-Darwinists don't want to leave that because it's big money business. Today, do you know if you have a pregnant woman, wife, and if you are a moneyed man, a company will come. We will preserve your child's cord blood for all times to come. Biggest myth. They'll make tons of money out of that. Nothing will come out of that. This all started with Stalin's death. They wanted to preserve Stalin's body. Nitrogen, liquid nitrogen. And tons of money. Even today there are people, rich people, preserving their body, hoping that someday technology will make them wake up and walk. Don't worry about that. Epigenetics. Have you heard of epigenetics? Read that.
Hello, doctor.
Hiller Hegde, not doctor. Hiller Hegde. You know that now in West, it's the stress. That everything is related to stress. I was talking to a psychotherapist, a lady, and she said, do you know that in India, it depends upon you? I can't make you angry. You make yourself angry. If you can get that through, you will not feel angry.
Good.
That your wife can't make you angry, your boss can't make you angry, you do it yourself. And that affects your health.
Correct.
So this is what I think very important for us to...
Absolutely right. You said it. And look at this young man. He is so healthy. Do you know why? He has got 14 kids. Out of which 4 are biological, 10 are adopted from different countries. And he enjoys them and he will never die. I can tell you that. He will never die. You don't have to have cryopreservation. He will not die at all.
Thank you.
You know, autoimmune disease is what is called horror autotoxicus. Your own body cells damaging your own body cells. You understand that? It's the most dangerous thing to happen. Now, your body cells and my body cells are the same. They love each other. Supposing you hate me, your body cells get confused. Why is she hating that poor man, Bhubiyamegde, poor chef, you know, he has come all the way here. Why is she hating him? Still you hate him. At one stage, your own body cells start hating your own body cells. That's called autoimmune disease.
So
if you have an autoimmune disease, sit in a quiet room and make a list of people you hate, you're angry with, as our friend said, and all that bad things, and make a list and forgive them. Autoimmune disease will gradually go down. No, that is a reductionist view. It is my passion. No memory. It's my passion.
A last comment. I was just observing that, I had an occasion to listen to other cardiologists, Dr. K.P. Mishra also. I was just wondering, why do all cardiologists after a certain time become more philosophical than actually believing in their cardiology? This was one. Second thing is, you made a comment about, if you're when the young lady they asked about a 4-year-old child getting some diseases like leukemias and all, you said that their mental status and they're fighting and doing all. Then do you mean to say that a person, if he dies young, he has a very bad mental status or something? Because Vivekananda died very young. And others, big criminals, they are living for more than 100 years and all. So, does the situation change in their mental faculty? And
oh my God, there's not one question. So many questions.
Yeah, and last was just a comment which I do agree that the pharmaceuticals do make a case for the disease. It was very evident recently with the swine flu epidemic, because the CEO of Tamiflu had 1 year before said that the total sale of the product would increase next year by 150%. How did he know? He was not a philosopher. He knew how to.
Good.
I definitely agree.
I will
with
answer
you.
Your last question first. The company which
Thank
manufactures
you.
Or sells Tamiflu is not the manufacturer. And the company which produced the swine flu test is the same company. And they caught hold of a doctor called Dr. Osterhaus, a Scandinavian doctor, and made him say H1N5 is a new virus and is killing all of you. And now he is called Dr. Flu. And this doctor now is in jail because he has found that he took $10 million from this company to create the disease. And there is nothing called swine flu. Swine flu was a hoax. There's nothing like Zika. Zika virus has been there for donkey's years. Now suddenly in Brazil, there's so much of chemical spraying that microcephaly has become a big problem. And the chemical companies, agricultural chemical, they didn't want the world to know. So they got hold of doctors to say, it's a Zika virus, we did it. Now it's all blown off. In Brazil, they found there's not a single child with microcephaly which had anti-Zika antibodies, number one. Number two, it's not K.P. Mishra and one or two examples are... You know, one swallow doesn't make a summer. Every doctor who thinks, if he thinks, T-H-I-N-C-K-S, then he will become a philosopher sooner than later. You know, when I wrote the first paper called Unconventional Wisdom in Medicine, 1968, people condemned me for that. And this paper was rejected by journals for 15 years. It was published in 1983 with my photograph on the blast head, where the editor said, I have never heard this sort of a thing. And when it was published, a surgeon in London wrote to me, Dr. Hegde, up until I read your article, I was also having similar thoughts, but I expressed it to my friends. They thought I was mad, so I kept quiet. Now I have taken 100 copies of your article, given it to all my friends. Thank you. They don't think I am that mad after all. Thank you very much. And